show excellence where there is equality. For every diversity hire, there is a diversity fire. It is not the similarities that make us the same. It is the differences that make us different. The truth is hate to those who hate the truth. Atonement cannot be made for a grievance never committed. There is no Western civilization without Western time. In a world of collectivism, individualism is suicide. Hollywood isn't history. Hollywood isn't history. Isn't history. Isn't history. Isn't history. Isn't history.
And we are rolling in, ladies and gentlemen. It is a wonderful Wednesday evening here in the once great state of Virginia. And we have a dear friend, Miss Loralee, with us today for a half an hour. How are you and how have you been, Loralee?
Well, Jason, I'm doing pretty well, all things considered.
It's so wonderful to have you back. I know that you have a lot of old fans that have been your fans in a long time still in the audience here, but there are
wonderful. Well, bless them all and to your audience at large, and thank them for listening in.
Yes, well, we have some new folks too. So if you could please maybe introduce yourself and what you do and what you've been working on.
Okay, well, first of all, I work with a combination of Jungian psychology, mythology, and astrology as a means of understanding one's personal psychology and providing tools to assist in actualizing one's potential and overcoming obstacles to self-realization. In addition to that, I've done a deep study of the Lord of the Rings as the myth for our time, and I was inspired along the way in my studies by statements made by both Carl Jung and Joseph Campbell, who said that myth is to a culture what dreams are to the individual. And that really captured my attention and imagination early on. And I wondered, wow, if that's the case, what is our myth? Because ancient cultures, every culture has its guiding myth. And however, Western, particularly Northern or North American culture, didn't seem to have a myth that pertained specifically to us. And but when I saw the first Lord of the Rings film in 2001, Fellowship of the Ring, it came to me very clearly that this is the myth for our time. And so I worked on that and have put together a video documentary series that analyzes the Lord of the Rings as the myth for our time. And it can be found on my website, and I'm sure you'll just go ahead and put that in the chat so I won't have to spell it all out.
Yes, right.
Anyway, the idea that this could be the dream of Western civilization. And so in the series, I analyze the symbols and the meaning of the characters and the story itself as if it were a dream. And when we think of things in that way, it can provide a deep understanding of the underlying meaning of the events that are taking place in our actual life, which on the surface can appear to be extremely chaotic and confusing and seemingly without any meaning. And yet, when we can understand that there is a myth running in the unconscious, and as Jung says, that this is a myth that runs for centuries in the unconscious, and that it comes to light in times of what he called the great movements, and that is a time like this, a time where we are in chaos, where the old structures of that, or at least that represented civilization, have collapsed and can no longer hold the center, right? The center cannot hold. And there's a lot of astrological dynamics that really describe that, you know, what's been going on, particularly in the last 4 years. And when we can have a sense of what is operating below the level of awareness in the unconscious, then having an understanding of these myths helps us to have that grasp of what the underlying meaning is. And when we feel confused and in chaos and wondering, you know, what on earth is going on and what's going to happen to us all, we can connect with these stories and myths that are innate to our Western culture, then it's a foundation of understanding that we can base our own personal life on, and then be able to move in terms of our building our own culture, or rebuilding our culture from the ground up, and using these mythic themes as a way to move forward and to bring forth the best of what is within us, the men and women of the West.
Wow, just absolutely magnificently stated. There are a few people that I will just get quiet and listen to, and Loralee is one of those folks. I just want to listen, and I just want to learn, and I hope you all feel the same way in the live chat. Really excited that Loralee has been working on this documentary series on the Lord of the Rings, and I think you said that you're gonna pick it up again and continue working on it.
Well, yes, I have that intention, but I have to say that the fifth episode that was finished just before, it was in 2019. And then, of course, the COVID came down upon us, and that kind of threw everything into turmoil in my own personal life and in just about everybody's life, I think.
Yeah.
So the episode that I was planning next is on the light. And in the image that we have on the screen there, that is Galadriel's vial that contains the light Erendil. And it is the light Erendil that Galadriel uses to ward off Sauron. So having an understanding of light, it's a huge thing. Like, you start looking into the symbolism of light and just studying the science of light, which is mind-blowing and amazing just in and of itself. That alone just opens up all kinds of possibilities, creative possibilities, because the light is really the life force of the universe. And when we can really feel into that, that's what gives us power. And it's also what we can then use to challenge the forces of evil. That is, and I consider, okay, so when I say the forces of evil, what I'm referring to is the anti-life force. So if you spell live or live backwards, you get evil. So evil is the anti-life force. And so how do we stand up to evil, the anti-life force, is by using the life force itself, the light. So that's my next episode, should it ever come to pass, but I am thinking about it. And what I'm concentrating on right now, though, is, I would say, a more necessary thing to understand, and that is the nature of the weapons of psychological warfare that have been deployed against us. And it seems to me that, you know, having lived through or barely the last 4 years, that we, the people, need to understand that we are at war. The world is at war. But the weaponry that's being used against us is not what we would usually expect. You know, they still like to use bullets, bombs, and they like to scare us to death about nukes and, oh my God, and EMP. And it's just a nonstop fear campaign, which is one of the tools of psychological warfare that is called trauma-based mind control. So if you keep the people in an almost constant state of fear, then neurophysiologically, we are unable to get out of the reptilian part of the brain, because if we are in a constant state of fear, then you're always in a state of, fight, flight, freeze. And you don't have access to the functioning of the prefrontal cortex that allows us as human beings to pause and say, okay, well, they're telling us scary stories right now. Maybe I can take a breath and just look at what is really happening to each of us as individuals on the ground where we live. And once you realize that for the most part, there isn't a knife to your throat, there isn't a bomb going off in your backyard, then we're able to calm the nervous system and be able to think more rationally about what is actually happening. And then how do we deal with that in a more conscious and creative way? And the key is creativity, because we cannot be creative if we are in a constant state of fear.
Very well said on so many points there. Very, very well said. What about astrologically, what are you seeing for this coming year and the kind of struggles we're going to have?
Oh boy. How much time we got here now? Well, let me give you the nutshell version that actually does connect with your own work, Jason, on Prometheus.
Okay.
And way back in 2020, actually, there was a combination of, a planetary alignment of Jupiter and Uranus that took place on the winter solstice 2020 at 0 degrees Aquarius. Aquarius is the myth of Prometheus in Greek mythology. So anybody familiar with Greek mythology will know that Prometheus was the god who defied the ruling order of Zeus and stole the sacred fire and brought it to humanity. Now, we need to keep in mind that the fire, the sacred fire, is the light. So what is in Prometheus' torch is the light, the life force of the universe. Now, on January the 21st of this year, Pluto, the planet of transformation, metamorphosis, death for the purpose of rebirth, has entered Aquarius. It dipped its toe into the sign last year. The period of time this year that it will be in Aquarius is, it started January 20th. It will be in Aquarius till September the 1st. Then it backs up until November the 20th, which is pretty interesting considering the election and all of that stuff going on. So it's going to step back in a way we can consider it as the last little cleanup operation of the collapsing structures that are represented by the sign of Capricorn. Now, Pluto is a 248-year cycle. So probably you or other people who are listening may know or may have heard that Pluto, that in the birth chart of the USA, Pluto recently experienced what is called a Pluto return. In other words, one 248-year cycle has come to closure. So the entity that is represented in the United States of America has undergone a metamorphosis, a death for the purpose of rebirth. And what is about to be introduced once Pluto enters the sign of Aquarius, which will be November, let me just get it exact, I think it's the 20th. Maybe the 20th. Oh, here we go, the 20th. Yep, that's it, the 20th of November. Then Pluto will be in Aquarius until 2043. So that really activates this myth of Prometheus and therefore fully awakens the Promethean spirit within all of humanity. And we're seeing it already, aren't we? There is protests and resistance to tyranny and the ruling order going on all over the world. So the Promethean spirit, because it is the light and the life force of the universe, it cannot be crushed. It is a force of nature. It can be, you know, stomped on and beaten up and, you know, pushed under the water, so to speak, but it cannot be crushed. So we are entering, therefore, a period of time or the next 20 years or so where we have an opportunity to reclaim the life force and to, you know, get rid of once and for all, you know, the eye of Sauron.
Amen to that. Thank God. Thank God. Amen to that. We need that to happen sooner rather than later.
So we sure do.
Yes, fascinating. Well, this you know, could bode well for this community who've been doing just Leviathan work against this anti-white behemoth that has crushed Western civilization and therefore the world under its heel. So that any sort of potential underpinning or power or faith in such things would be most welcomed, or is most welcomed, I must say, especially because we were talking about just a little bit in our messaging about how so many of our brothers and sisters across the West are unable to identify genuine leadership for our people. Like I'm 100% certain that we can look back through time and we can look at our greatest leaders. We could look at like Andrew Jackson for a name that's close here in the United States, for example. And I am 100% certain that today, if Andrew Jackson suddenly existed again, that probably very few white people would have any interest in him whatsoever as a legitimate leader of our people. What are your thoughts on that? And how do you see, or why do you see that happening in our people, and what might change that?
Well, you know, the little discussion we had before we went live regarding the usurpation of our language, that in order to really reclaim our mind from the indoctrination and the weapon of mind control, is to reclaim our language, because it's a weapon that's been used against us. I mean, it's right out of 1984, you know, ignorance is strength, war is peace, you know, freedom is slavery. And So reclaiming our language, I think, is extremely important. And from there, moving to a deeper understanding of the underlying myths that are at work in our psyche. And as Jung said, you know, these mythic themes are alive, and they run in the unconscious from generation to generation to generation. So it's not something that just pops up out of nowhere. But these archetypal themes are there underlying everything that goes on in the outer world, because everything comes out of the imaginal. Anything made by humans starts first in the imagination, in the realm of the imaginal. So we are under attack from two directions. The war on for our mind. I mean, that's most people certainly probably listening to this already know that.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's Alex Jones' words, you know, there's a war on for your mind, because there is. But I would say what's even worse is the war on for our imagination.
Yes.
And I guess the good news there is that it hasn't been fully conquered yet, but they're really, really pushing hard on that now, because if you can colonize the imagination, then it completely destroys the ability to create anything new. Anyone who has their imagination colonized is unable to access the divine imagination. And so you're locked in to whatever has been deposited in your own psyche. And that is why they're going for the children. This is why the target now is children, young children, very young children, right? Because children are in a state of what is called the magical thinking. So the structure of the ego doesn't really solidify till around 7 years old. But prior to that, children have very easy access to the imagination, especially young children. And, you know, they have magical friends and imaginary friends, and they, you know, can talk to the animals, and, you know, there's not so much of a barrier between rational, logical assessment of things and imagination. And it's that innocence that is now a real target for the foe. And so we really need to take care of the imagination. And I would say that the way to do that is to understand mythology, because then you have a way to use your rational, logical mind to understand the workings of the psyche and to be able to intervene when something that is toxic is being deposited in, you know, our own adult imagination. But we really need to protect the children.
Without question. And I really like the way you articulated that it's a colonizing of the mind, a colonizing of our spirit. And this this idea, something that I've argued for a long time, and I think maybe the next time we have you back, I would like to really go into a little deeper about the underlying mythos and how this is what we, you know, here refer to as biospiritually. This is a creation of our biospirit that recurs. It doesn't go away. It doesn't, the names can change that we apply to these different things. And this is what I believe I was tapping into when I wrote Prometheus Rising, which I will be over the course of this year creating the audio version, the audiobook version of, and very excited
about. Fantastic.
Yeah, thank you. Very excited about doing that. But there is this mechanistic view and sort of approach, because I think that we've had, as a people, Western kind, we've had so much success with the scientific method and this digging into sort of the soil of the earth, the rocks of the earth, and examining and creating a formulae, and then applying these recurrently and coming out with the same outcomes, and then being able to build and construct things based on the laws that we're able to write as a consequence. But I think what has ended up happening is this in-between space, sort of this, you know, like this liminal space between the microscope that looks in sort of inward at our DNA and the microscope that looks outward at the soil. There is this creative space that that sort of magically continues on this cycle that, as long as we are, it is. And that's something that I think is, in the modern age, wholly overlooked, and something that I think also, when we try to use religion, which is not to say religion is a bad thing, but when we try to use religion to understand this liminal space, it corrupts it to a degree. It can get in a way to a degree, and which is why I think that it's got to be, it has to be kept pure in just in and of itself. But I wonder if, before we let you go, if you have any thoughts to that, I would, what I just said, any of it, I would really like to hear.
Well, with regards to religious traditions and the stories that underlie religious experience, I mean, it can be viewed as myth as well. And that's not to say that, you know, it's it doesn't exist. I mean, there's a word right there, myth. I mean, it's been translated as, oh, it means it's wrong. You know, it's just a myth.
Right.
So just even reclaiming that word, but to understand that all the stories, whether it's coming through religious traditions that we're familiar with, just let's say Christianity. I mean, what is the basis of Christianity in the story of Jesus, the king? It's the archetype of kingship. Mm-hmm. And that is a central theme in Lord of the Rings. Mm-hmm. And you were referring earlier to this idea of leadership. Well, leadership is really kingship. It's the ability, first of all, to master your own inner realm. So a man who would claim to be a leader who wants to be a leader must first claim mastery over his own inner realm, his own emotions. And then once that is taken care of as best as we can, well, then you build the realm right around you, your home, your family, your business, your close friendships. And then once that is in place, then a man can step out to portray himself as a potential leader in a larger community. And it calls upon each and every individual, since we're talking kingship, man, who is stepping up to say, yeah, I've, you know, mastered my inner realm. I have my personal realm intact. And now I'm going to step out into the larger world, but not to be a follower. A king is not a follower. A king is a man who has realized that capacity in himself and is willing to then step up and stand shoulder to shoulder with other men of kingly stature. Just like in Lord of the Rings, Aragorn does not say, okay, everybody, I'm the king now, and y'all have to, you know, bow down and follow my orders. Instead, what he does is encourages each of the members of the fellowship to rise to their own kingship. And then they, because they don't feel diminished and they don't feel like subjects of the king, then they can rise to their greatness in their own realm of being. And they can recognize in this case, Aragorn, as being a leader because he shows the capacity for that. And a man who is of kingly stature within himself is able to say, okay, yeah, that man is a man I can stand shoulder to shoulder with. Yeah. I'm not the one to be the leader. I'm the master of my realm here, and this is where I rise to my greatness. And I can stand with a man who may, you know, ride out like Aragorn did at the front of the line, right? Because yes, that's what's required of a man who's going to step up and say, okay, I'm willing to, you know, meet Sauron. then, you know, you don't do it alone, and you don't, you know, get a bunch of underlings who are just going to obey and, you know, grovel to you. You want to have an army of other men of kingly stature.
That is so perfectly said. That and that's how I see the problem, this insidious problem of so many of our people choosing the wrong leadership, because they have not risen to their potential, the king in themselves.
Right.
And so if they can't find the king in themselves, mm-hmm, then they can never see the king to whom they should stand shoulder to shoulder. Instead, mm-hmm, they remain in this almost sort of like, to use a word, I guess, from Lord of the Rings, this halfling state.
Yes.
Where they just become a worshiper, a follower, mm-hmm, of the latest content creator that can keep their attention.
Yeah, I call that infantilization. I think the entire culture has been infantilized, kept as an infant. And part of the entrainment and the indoctrination has taught children, especially, that you know, big daddy government or some institution or some particular person who seems to present themselves as an authority figure is who you need to follow. And right, that is what children do, infants do. And we can't be infants anymore. We must first of all realize that we are being infantilized. That's one of the methods of psychological warfare and control. And once that awareness happens, it's like, oh, well, wait a minute. I'm not an infant. And what do I need to do to develop my personal self to be a king or a queen? And then things open up. The creative process opens up.
Beautiful.
But it's not easy.
No.
So that's another thing that I think is important, because we've all been, I think, conditioned to think that, you know, it's the quick fix. Oh, well, I'll just take this pill, or I'll, you know, have a weekend workshop or something like that, and then it's all going to be good and I'm never going to have a bad day again.
Right.
Because the truth is, once you choose to go on the hero's journey, the first thing that happens is that you got to go to the underworld.
Right. Yeah. And that's a great way. And that's a great spot to cut it off, cut and thrust for the next time. You got to go on the hero's journey. And the first place you got to go is the underworld. We can pick it up right there the next time we bring you on. Do you have any final thoughts before we let you go? You've been absolutely splendid, Loralee.
Oh, well, thanks, Jason. No, not anything else, but this has been a great conversation. Short, but good. I'll be excited to get deeper into things next time.
Awesome. Well, and we have, folks, we dropped the link in the live chat, and I'll put it in the description when we're done here today. And Loralee, it was wonderful, and we'll have you back real soon, okay?
All right. Thank you. And thank you for your audience for listening.
Oh, amen. Bye-bye now.
Bye for now.
Wow, how exciting was that? Had Loralee on. We'll have her back real soon. I saw folks in the live chat really enjoying her being with us, and I know I was. She's so interesting to listen to. We've got some other items to get to, but before we roll into our very first story that we're going to cover tonight, which is the illegal intruders here to seize your home. And make no mistake, they'll be voting for your home here in the very near future because they'll have the votes to do that. And then my prediction from junior high school that I told the adults, and they said, no, it would never happen. And I said, they'll vote the car out of your driveway and the house out from underneath of your ass. That will come true. And think about all those adults that told that 11, 12-year-old child how wrong he was. But if you would like to financially gift over the course of this gathering, Entropy is up and running and looking wonderful. You also have Odyssey as an option for cryptocurrency or cash dollars. We have DLive is up and running, almost wasn't going to be up and running, but it is, and the cryptocurrency there. We are also, of course, on streaming to Twitter, and you can leave comments there, and I can see those comments here. You can leave comments across all of these platforms, including Rumble. I have that up and running. For financial gifting, we also have Cash App and Subscribe Star. Everybody who financially gifts over the course of our roll-in gathering today will have their comment or question read, and I will speak directly to it. Otherwise, tag me as No White Guilt and on any of the platforms, No White Guilt, and I will read your comment or question. This is about learning. It is about changing the world that we're in. So please participate. I see First Last is with us. And we have Matt is here. Cool Papa J Magic. The champions have shown up. I want to also show you my prototype shirt. There would be a change to it. Maybe the address for the website will be larger because it's invisible. They're not invisible. They can be read, but you got to get up real close. I mean, if somebody wanted to see the address, they would have to be like right up on your pec muscles. And that might be weird, although you might like that. I don't know. Depends on what kind of person you are. But I've got it on. It's Trump Musk, the scent of victory. And we need, if you are an artist who believes that you could create a tribal Westman shirt for us, reach out to me. You can do so on Twitter. It's probably one of the most reliable places to reach out. If I'm not following you, make sure you're following me and then tag me in a tweet and say that you have sent me a direct message. That way, I will be able to see that you've sent a message and I will take a look at what you wrote and we'll take a look at your work, what you've done before. But this is where we are right now. I had to make this into a t-shirt because it was so funny. The scent of victory. Promethean healing is here. Is it scratch and sniff shirt? Well, that's a thought. That is a thought. I could sell the shirt after I've rubbed it. Every shirt I could rub all over my body and then sell, and then it would have the musk of power coming off of it. So maybe that would work. Cool Papa J Magic. Janice is here. Ivan the Huggable is with us. Rick Freedom, the great Franklinator, is here. I saw the great biospirit of the West a little earlier. One of Western kind. Talk about the champions have shown up to have a heed to Loralee. Isn't she interesting? You're not going to find so many of the folks who are interested in the same things that she investigates and researches and et cetera, they have this hollow hubris to them, this kitschy blankness, this vapidness, but she doesn't. She's a very interesting person and has keen insight. And so we're definitely going to have her back. We really enjoy her and what she shares. I mean, just imagine, what if starting around November 20, was it that she said, of this year, all the way up until, 2045 or something, there is this extra cosmic wind at our back. I mean, just imagine it, you know, but just imagine that. Wouldn't that be wonderful? The great thunder from down under is present. Great to see you. Good, sir. White Wolf is with us. Who else is here today? Make sure you say hello. Masumik, great to see you, sister. Promethean Kitchen is here. Rory, I think I saw Rory earlier, did I? Did you ask if I wanted to go down to Florida? Florida. Pablo, honey. Does anybody remember that? Pablo, honey. Are you washing your ass, Pablo? Vigil is here. Hello and welcome. Rise is here. Rasca Rise. Hello and welcome. Cindy Ben, Curtis Price. Welcome to you all. Marluxia is here as well. Rory says his daughter is pregnant with twins. They're due in June. So they will probably be, is that Geminis? Well, congratulations, and again, for that. That's going to be wonderful. It's going to be a happy granddaddy in the community. Kingdom of Inland is with us. The great Four Null is in the house. All right, let's go ahead and see what there is to see. We had Grace tweet about retweet a monster. She wrote, the Biden administration wants you to share your home with these criminals. If you don't want to, then no worries. The criminal is telling others they can take what they want. And when they run out of empty homes to take, don't think they will stop there. So let's see if we can have a look at this piece of garbage.
Podemos expropiarla.
Let's go back to the beginning.
Mi gente, he pensado.
First thing I notice, he has a thought now. What's he say?
Mi gente,
I have a thought about invading a house in United States. And our Spanish speakers here, if this is at all the translation here incorrect, then please cue me in on what is really being said. It could be even worse than the translation. But so the first thing I notice is this guy is on TikTok, I understand, and he's got some colossal audience. Does anybody know how big this rabid anti-white monster's audience is? I mean, and people are defending TikTok, but he's got this massive audience, and here he is. Does he look like a woman with children? Does he look like, no, this is the reality of the criminal intruders. This guy, he uses the word invading. Can we call him an invader yet? I mean, when they call themselves invaders, when they march across the border into the United States with the flags of the shithole countries they came from, can we finally call them invaders without getting strikes and losing platforms and et cetera? I mean, when can we refer to them as invaders? So have a close look at this guy, because he's going to show up at your fucking house. He's going to show up at your house and he's going to say, this is our house now, and some sort of anti-white slur. So he's saying he's an invader. Let's invade. And he's pissed off. He's absolutely pissed off. Is this the meek, mild, and don't even focus on that, really. I'm just posing the question because you know the anti-whites tomorrow, 2 hours from now, 30 seconds from now, they'll have no problem finding a crisis actor or whatever else. They'll have no problem digging through the hordes of them, Camp of the Saints style, that have flooded into the country and finding an actual innocent, harmed, long-suffering mestizo mother or other non-white mother with a couple of brown babies that will be crying and starving, although they are ballooned up fat. They'll have no problem finding that. But this is the reality of what's behind it, because that has to be the mentality. You don't break into someone's country without the mentality that breaks into their homes. And that's what this piece of living shit is saying. Come over and try to invade my house, motherfucker. Let's go. You want to come and squat in my house? Let's have a go. Piece of shit. So he's pissed off. He's like, we're going to take it. We're going to invade. And here are the ways to exploit the laws of this land in our favor. Well, that's all they do. That's how they get into the country and stay into the country. It is all an exploitation of our rules and codes and laws and norms, the white erasure of all of these things, exploiting all that we have in place.
Una casa en United States. Ya que me enteré que existe una ley que dice que si una casa.
So he found a law that says if, could you imagine if he did this in China, they would just shoot his ass on the spot. They wouldn't fuck around one bit. And you know what? If we had a real leader, like we were just talking with Loralee about, if we had a real leader, that's what would happen to people like this. Paying them to go home.
Casa no está habitada. Podemos expropiarla. Capiche?
Yeah, seize it. Seize their house. Seize someone's house. How do you know if it's abandoned? Because we look across the country. We just had a case up in Queens, New York, I think it was. All over the country, homes are being seized that are lived in. Homes that are rented from one tenant to the next are being seized by these people. And what happened up there in Queens just the other day? The owner of the home, who had received it as a bequest from her dead mother or whatever, $1 million apparently place. It's not really glorious, I don't think. It's just its location. She had received the home, and these kinds of folks, they decide they're just going to move in. These anti-white monsters just move in like maggots, and they set up and they're like, this is our house now. You can't do anything. It's her furniture's in the house. Her mother's furniture, her furniture is in the house. They're just living in it now. So the mother just dies and they just go occupy the house. So is it uninhabited? I mean, how does a living human excrement like this decide what's uninhabited? You follow me? I mean, if they're willing to break into our country, break into our houses, steal our stuff, call it invasion, do you really think they're going to honor the definition of uninhabited? Give me a break. So how do you think it turned out there up in Queens? How do you think it played out? Well, the landlord showed up with the news, because this is like what landlords have recourse now, or not landlord, it's the owner of the property, given the property by her mother who died. So the owner of the property shows up with police because and news crew, because these landlords and homeowners who are not landlords, but homeowners, they have no recourse. They show up and they're like, who are these people? And the courts defend the squatters. You know what? You know when the courts will stop defending the squatters? When there are too few white people who own properties anymore. Then suddenly it'll be, oh, you're getting, and it'll be Guatemala style. The guy will show up and he's like, this is my house. And the police will look and they'll say, oh, it is your house. Bam, 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 bam. Let us drag the corpses out. Then it will change. But as long as it's victimizing white people at present, well, then it's going to stay in place. As long as the majority of people being harmed are white, and as long as it's a white standard and customs that are being white erased, it will stand. Guaranteed. So she shows up and she's like, these people, I have no idea who they are. I'm not renting this place. They aren't tenants. Get out. This is my house. And she said, while the TV crew was there, and she said, I have a truck, locksmith down the street to put new locks on this place. So with the police there and the film crew there and the reporter asking, like, who are you? Did you sign a lease? And how? Why do you think you can live here? They left. The locksmith came up and then put new locks on the place. The police left. The film crew and the woman were still there. The thieving anti-white monsters busted into the house and told her to get out, that it was their house. So the police were called again. And except this time, she went to jail. Nobody went to jail the first time. The police just left. They left. Police left. This time she went to jail for wrongfully evicting them. You're not going to be able to sit around and continue to talk about abstractions. You've got to get over this. You've got to get over following losers that start up political parties and that just give you doom documenting for content creation. You've got to become a player in the recapture of our destiny, or America, Canada, everything's going down the toilet. And there'll be no mercy showed to the white race. This will be, take a close look at his face. Take a close look at his face. That's going to be what shows up, except it won't be one. There'll be many anti-whites, and they'll be armed. We'll get to that in a moment.
Muchachos, aquí en United States también se aplica la de invasión de terreno.
Land invasion.
Y creo que ese será mi próximo.
So his next business is invading, is what he's saying. That's his next business. I wonder what his previous business was. Fentanyl distribution, raping white women and white little girls, maybe white little boys as well. We don't know what he's into. What was the previous business? I'm going to go ahead and guess it was something that we would, in the past, when we controlled our destiny, we would execute the shit out of someone for committing. So his new business is going to be invading your home, white person. How about right now, the Biden administration, the anti-whites, and this is not just Biden's, not just Democrats, but Republicans too. There's a visa, there is a no visa program in place for people who live, who are Chile, is it Chilean? What is it? Is it Chile and some other country? They don't have to have a visa to come to America. Are you fucking nuts? Did you all know this? Did you all know that nationals of third world countries can get on a plane and fly into the United States with no visa? Like United States and Chile are just the same country. Did you know this? Well, they're pouring in and robbing homes, an international mafia of home invaders who are there to not necessarily squat like this guy's talking about and steal your house from you, but to steal all of your things, maybe rape a little bit of your children and your wife. What happens when, and the media, by the way, is making these mafia sound innocuous. What were they calling them? Something like the robbing organization or something retarded. This is a mob. You know what happens when home invaders who are there to criminalize come upon a homeowner or homeowners, it's not like a, hey, how are you? Well, we're just here to rob. No, they get brutalized. They get raped. They get killed. That's what ends up happening. So make sure I'm right about this. No need for visa. It was said by Fox. So if it's wrong, then Fox is wrong. But check it out for yourself. But that these third worlders can fly right into your hometown. Guys, just like this. And don't, nobody who has any brains here is going to say something like, doesn't scare me. I got my revolver here. Fuck you. What about all the houses that don't have revolvers or people who are not as brave as you? Or people who have a slew of kids that are going to be harmed by the invasion, and maybe you don't because you have Rottweilers and a revolver. Fucking grow up. Stop being such a coward. You are, if you are waiting for somebody like this to show up at your house so that you can shoot them and then go to prison and get executed for it, if you're waiting for that, you're a loser and you're a coward and you're making excuses for not protecting the weakest among us. And also yourself. This is the selfish individualism that we have to extirpate. We have to tear out of our soul. Nobody here says anything like that. We use these concepts to liberate our people, to put an end to something like this. For all those households out there who are not going to have a guy brave enough and sharpshooting enough, or a woman brave enough and sharpshooting enough to be able to take down the home invader. And it still, it doesn't matter, because when the police come, you're going to jail because you're white.
Invadir casas abandonadas, ya que me he buscado unos códigos con mis amigos.
So his amigos, blacks, have done this to seven houses already. So they've stolen seven homes. So what is this weird union with this Hispanic and the blacks that he's referring to? It's that they're anti-white. That's the union.
Africanos. Y me dijeron que ya llevan como siete casas expropiadas.
Y como, as the saying goes, daddy.
Como dice el dicho, papi, hay que buscar la vuelta.
Okay, so apparently, as the saying goes, you have to look for the return on your theft. You have to look for the return on your villainy. So it's sort of like a bastardization of ROI for white people. ROI, where you create value for customers and then they make you rich. This is, you steal and you get more return than your effort to thieve. It would take quite a lot to steal a house otherwise.
Y la vuelta ahorita mismo,
the return right now,
es invadir,
to invade the house.
Ya que nos encontramos en situación de,
since we are not in a street situation,
calle, y es la única manera que tenemos para no vivir en la calle.
Don't have to live in the street.
Calle, y no ser una carga pública.
And look at this little cute thing he says. And be a public burden. This sounds like the mafia guy who ran like the several blocks, and he would show up at your little store, your little pizzeria. And he shows up and he's like, I'm just here for the protection payment. You know, you wouldn't want me to be a public burden. This is a threat. You wouldn't want me to be a public burden. Oh, really? How would you be a burden to me? Because if I'm in charge, your ass is swimming home. So you're not a burden to me. That's a threat. We get the house and then we're not a public burden anymore.
Capici? La ley dice que las casas abandonadas.
The law said, could you imagine using the laws against us? Could you imagine if you went to, I don't know, Iran, and you said, hey, your law says this. I found a loophole in a way to exploit it. They'd cut your head off. They would take you to the top of a building and throw you right off of it.
Deteriorada y que esté en mal estado, podemos llegar y repararlas.
Oh, yeah. This is trying to soften the whole invasion thing. Like, we'll fix up the houses. I see how they fix them up.
Vivir en ella y si podemos venderla. Hasta
Mestizo Carver's with us, and he points out that the guy says, he said capiche. Did he really? Is capiche in Spanish? Or did he just use capiche from Italian? Wow.
A pedir créditos con ella. ¿Qué dicen ustedes?
What do you say? I say, better get your water wings on, buddy. Because if I or somebody like me gets in charge, you're swimming home. And it's a long swim. We'll drop you in the middle of the Gulf. You'll find the way. Or you won't. I don't give a shit. But what's connected to this, folks? It's that a judge, an Obama appointee, just ordered the other day that the federal law that banned illegals from having firearms is unconstitutional. And so illegals can have, people who are non-citizens can have firearms. There is no logic to that whatsoever. There is no law behind that whatsoever. This is purely an anti-white ruling. And the more positions that fall under, these more nodes of power that fall under the sway or control of anti-whites, the worse and worse this will get. I mean, we just had Katanji, as though anybody with a name like Katanji should be a judge in America. Give me a break. Could somebody with my name rule Nigeria? Get the fuck out of here. So Katanji, she's at the bench the other day, and she's like, well, we got a real freedom of speech issue here because there's heretical speech to anti-whiteism, and the government should be able to interact. And then she likened the population of the United States to children. I mean, this is the thinking of your average female, by the way. You can't just, she said something like, you can't just tell the kids no. Let's open that up. Let me see what y'all are saying about this. Capiche, my God. Well, then, I mean, I guess he should be handled. If he wants to be, and this is clearly what he's doing, thuggish, mafioso, criminal, then maybe somebody needs to drop a fish on his front door. The house he steals from someone. Wrap the fish up, drop it on the front door, stoop. Solid behind blue eyes. Hello and welcome. Arturo, hello to you. Bryce, hello to you. Alex is here, great to see you. 0022. 0022 is in the house. Real Raven. Corey is here. Hello and welcome. St. Thomas is with us. Welcome to you. Rufus is here. Great to see you. Red Dog is in the house. Unacceptable living in left field. Hello and welcome. Remember to tag me as No White Guilt if you'd like to get a comment to me. Oh, it looks like Carlisle is with us. Hello, young lady. Kinfolk is with us. Hello, hello. All right. So, you had an illegal intruder who was in, I think, Chicago, who decided to take out the gun he had obtained illegally and begin shooting. I mean, just imagine how far down the road we are. We all have faced law-abiding citizens in this country, white people and good non-white people, have faced nothing but endless attacks on our right to self-defense, which is enshrined in the Second Amendment of the United States Constitution. Our entire lives, it's been under attack. Our entire lives, every movie, every TV show, every news cycle of Congress, every news cycle, they are taking away our rights to defend ourselves. Everywhere we turn, they are taking away our rights to defend ourselves. And then you have this anti-white, repulsive judge who decides, well, this person is part of the anti-white war on Western kind, on Westmen, on America. So, of course, they get to be armed. It just doesn't get any clearer. I have figured all of this out. True champions who have figured it out are here with us. There's no more need to debate. We need to form a massive antibody out of the population of folks who can see and take it to the anti-whites. Now, all of these abstractionists that want to get together and continue debating about maybe it's this and maybe it's that. You know, I mean, let's just do the abstractionist. Well, maybe it's over here. Maybe it's one of those things. And how many people have shown up at $700 a ticket to hear me talk about bullshit? How many of you would like to watch me pedantically prattle on and on and on and on? Give me a break. We have figured out this is psychological warfare. You don't need to debate it anymore. Debating can stop. We know what's going on. We have a formula that perfectly explains that it happened, how it happened, how it's happening right now, and make predictions that come true all the time. Near-term predictions that come true again and again. Further afield predictions that come true again and again. A formula that works for everybody who applies it to their lives. A formula that everything I articulated, this is beyond the equivalent of me walking on water. This is the equivalent when I have come to our people and I have said, here is the formula. Here is the practice. Here is how it works. Here is how it will be adopted. Here, and all of that comes true. That's the equivalent of me raising up a planet, Nirvana style, Eden planet right before your eyes. Where the fuck is everybody? Let's talk more about it. Let's speculate more about how it happens and who's behind it. And let's just complain endlessly.
A judge in Illinois just ruled illegal immigrants have the right to keep and bear arms. So rather than the circle with the line through it, we need like a thumbs up emoji there. The case is pretty simple. Police arrested an illegal immigrant living in Chicago with a gun back in 2020. They charged him for violating the federal law banning illegal immigrants from having guns. Been on the books for a long time. Judge Sharon Johnson Coleman just decided the Second Amendment applies to him, the illegal immigrant, like everybody else. So
this is, now, this is the kind of thing that our conservative brothers and sisters, they would just sit around shaking their heads like, yeah, it just makes no sense. I'm so confused. I feel like it makes no sense. These people are not American citizens. So how do our laws apply to them? How do our protections apply to them? Because it's anti-whiteism. Because it victimizes white people. A lot. taking our protections and giving them, stripping them from citizens and white citizens and any good non-white people who will stand with us, and then giving those protections to foreigners achieves anti-white outcomes. That's how. That's how this works. Nancy Drew is with us. Good to see you. Neverland Song. Hello. That's a pretty cool name.
He can have a gun. In her decision.
Look at the judge. An Obama appointee. I wonder what's going on. You know, all the non-white races, you can look at the data yourself. They're all the biggest employers of their own kind. Except for white people.
She wrote
that. Make sure I'm right. But look at this woman. She's given the opportunity to be educated in a world created by white men, to go to an institution created by white men, to study laws created by white men, then to have the authority of a judgeship in a white man's created country. And then how does she give thanks? She empowers anti-white invaders with firearms. That's how she gives thanks. That's how she says thank you to you. All you white people out there, all of us, all of our brothers and sisters out there who are all, they're so genteel about race. They're so genteel about pointing out how we're being victimized, because that's just, it's gauche and it feels like it's immoral. Well, because you've been taught that it's immoral, dipshit. All those kind of, so many of those folks would say, what doesn't she should be able to have her views? She should be able to, fuck that. Ban anti-whiteism.
That Humberto Flores received and used the handgun solely for self-protection and protection of property during a time of documented civil unrest.
So let me ask you, if I or you, as a white man or woman, use a legally obtained firearm to defend ourselves and property. So it says, yeah, solely for self-protection and proper protection of property, protection of your property. How many judges do you think would write this about us? Not Flores, but Kuna or Smith. Jones, on and on. How many? Zero. This anti-white, filthy piece of shit would absolutely interpret the law in the most anti-white way that she can to strip us of our right to self-defense, to drag us through lawfare, to drag us through family courts, to potentially jail us, to fine us enormous sums, to bankrupt us, especially in a time when inflation is as high as it is. No, she's coming to the defense of Flores because he is an anti-white that represents all the anti-white non-white people coming into the United States. She knows that with this case, she can set a precedent. They can carry firearms. Look at what's happening in California. They're giving them all these police officers made out of foreigners, invading foreigners, intruder, I should say, foreigners are being made into law enforcement who will be a carry firearms and who will be able to demand of you your identification. Do you want to still talk about abstractions? Do you want to attend another conference from abstractionists about what's going on? What are your thoughts on it? And intellectually masturbate until the fires that are consuming this country, just like Rome, engulf you and your family? Is that what you're going to wait for?
In the spring of 2020, the summer of love.
Okay, so listen to what he says right there.
Documented civil unrest in the spring of 2020, the summer of love. Court documents.
And then he has like a little tiny bit of a smirk. They're like, I got him. I called it the summer of love. You idiot. You absolute moron with a nice head of hair. For fuck's sake. This is the psychological warfare that we were just briefly talking about with Loralee. Giving you the concepts with which to hang yourself. Could you imagine any, could you imagine Israelis calling October 7th the invasion of love? I mean, I am in hell. This is hell. This is hell for the white race. And what makes it hell is that so many white people just, they can't identify real leadership. They can't identify even something working. And they're like, no, thanks. It's not like all the failing we've been doing. So I'm sticking with that. You really get to see how utterly, I don't know, maybe I'll make up a word, boobish white people are when you imagine trying to convince Israelis to call October 7th the invasion of love or the day of love. I mean, you have wholesale, what did they have on October 7th? They had rape, they had murder, they had maimings. What have we had here? Rape, murder, maimings. White people's lives have no value whatsoever. There are massive gang rapes of white women, of white teenage boys, bludgeonings, disfigurement. Every time you turn on, every time you look at all out into the world, you see anti-whites, and most often it's anti-white non-whites, crushing the skulls of white people, ganging up 40 on one, 20 on one. And what was happening during that summer? An anti-white war was waged on Western civilization. Not only did they rape, attack, and maim white people, set our cars on fire, they set houses of records on fire. They set churches on fire. They pulled down our statues. So they went even further than happened in Israel, than what the Arabs did in Israel. But for some reason, the Jews are smart enough to not call their victimization the invasion of love. The day of love. I wonder why. But you come over here to a Western country, you talk to a bunch of these boobish white people, and here I am, folks. Here I am. Here's Fournol. Here's Franklin. Here's Biospirit of the West. Here's Brand Danger. Here is First Last. Here are so many white people that are here for the white race to say, okay, those are the people that I'm going to follow. Those are the folks I'm going to heed. We're here. If the white race doesn't follow, then what can be done? If the white race is going to do this, what can be done? Summer love. You know, as long as you have these dickless Ken dolls like this on air saying things like summer love, they're never going to want to talk to somebody like me. Never. That's how you know that the real leadership of Western kind is suppressed. And the faux leadership, the leadership that insidiously leads Western kind step by step into our oblivion, is always talked about. They just talked about another little half Mexican the other day. I mean, it couldn't get any clearer that it's a controlled operation.
And show Flores fired the gun at moving cars during the BLM riots in Chicago. He argues police officers warned.
So this, just as an aside, Flores fired his illegally obtained firearm at cars that were driving by. Just, you know, just as an aside. That's all I've been able to find out about this case. If there's more, please let me know. But this guy, he feared, so he just shot at cars driving by. What would happen to you, white guy, If you randomly shot at cars driving by because you claimed you were afraid for your property and life.
Warned him about looters who were approaching his neighborhood. Key to this ruling is the judge says...
So you hear that looters are approaching your neighborhood. So you decide to just pick up your piece, head out there and start shooting at cars that go by. Oh, you're fine. Fine. Not a citizen and you feel like doing that? Fine. I do that and that's it. Y'all would never see me again. I mean, there is no logic. Our conservative brothers and sisters right now would begin talking ad nauseum about how does it make sense? Where is the logic in that? Patricia, where would you find, where do you find the logic in it? Well, Steve, I don't find any logic in it. Where's the logic in it? And they would just go on and on. Anti-whiteism. That's what it is. It's a double standard. Because it's anti-whiteism. They get to an anti-white outcome with contradictory positions.
Flores' conduct heavily impacted her decision. He had no criminal record and was not considered a risk to public safety. This case...
He has no criminal... How do you know whether or not he has a criminal record? He's a non-citizen.
Is just one of many challenging... not considered a risk to public safety.
And how can you conclude he's not a risk to public safety when he randomly shot at cars driving by?
This case is just one of many challenging that federal statute that prevents illegal immigrants from possessing a firearm. There are cases unfolding in states nationwide. Shan Wu is here, former federal prosecutor, turned criminal defense.
So, typical of the news in America, the conservative news, got to go to an official, a brain, somebody to speak on this. It's not going to be a white man unless he is as homosexual as they come. It's always going to be a non-white person. I'm sure he's a great guy, but my country.
Attorney wants a very senior officer at the DOJ. Good to see you. Should I be shocked that an Obama appointee found a gun control law that she didn't like?
No, but I think it's very fascinating that this whole push towards expanding the deference to the Second Amendment, in some ways, has kind of come full circle here, where something that really seems counterintuitive, the idea that someone who's not here legally still has that right, and you can't use this particular statute, which is commonly known as the felon in possession statute. But the way it's written, she really zeroed in on the language. He's not a felon. And the gray area, of course, is whether or not his status, and frankly, I think the way he was using the gun calls a little bit into question, you know, how peaceful
right.
he is.
No, I get-
of course. And do you see how this sort of minutiae and this pacifistic approach to, I think it's called into question and we really should deliberate over this, or there should be some conversation. We can have an intellectual debate. No, there's no more debate. It's anti-whiteism. That's clearly why this anti-white, non-white bitch did this. It's clearly anti-white.
I guess the question, though, is what constitutional rights and protections then become absolute, right? Because illegal immigrants are still counted in a census. Mm-hmm. That is a huge deal in terms of representation. But then where do we get for to right to work or right to vote or right to have a license to practice medicine or right to have a license to do all of these other things? Isn't this opening Pandora's box?
It could be. I do think, I hate to say this, but I think Congress would have to be a little bit more powerful here, because there's no question that the Constitution applies to people who are not here legally. They're quote persons under the Constitution. So that makes perfect sense. The problem here is you need to draw the statute.
That doesn't make perfect sense. You should be an outlaw. If you snuck into this country, you should be an outlaw. And the proper definition of that is someone for whom the law does not apply. If you're going to break into my house, then the laws that protect you as a citizen aren't going to protect you as the intruder.
More narrowly, and you might have to actually specify that being here in a non-legal status would also make you not eligible to carry the firearm.
Interesting. You have to think about
it. Yeah, no shit. Like, when you purchase a firearm in America, you have to be law abiding. You have to, you can't have the arrests. Everybody's been, whoever's been to a gun show, they've seen when those rare occasions when somebody tries to come in and buy a firearm with some background, some arrest, confinement for psychological reasons, and they're not allowed to own a firearm, and they fill out the paperwork, and then as it's running, state troopers quietly walk up around them and say, "You're going to be coming with us," and they walk them off. So you have to be as clean as a whistle. You got to bend over for the colonoscopy to, if you're a citizen, to buy a firearm. It's ridiculous the amount of time that you have to wait for all of that to go through. It is absolutely ridiculous. Oh, but hey, if you are an illegal and don't know anything about you, but you're anti-white, then yes, of course you can have a firearm. Shoot at random cars going by.
What you said of Congress actually doing its job, which they rarely seem to be able to do. Key part of the ruling, Justice Clarence Thomas wrote in the court's majority opinion, "We hold that when the Second Amendment's plain text covers an individual's conduct, the Constitution presumptively protects that conduct." Look, you talk to a lot of folks. You're pretty popular in liberal legal circles. Was there a bit of chuckling when people read this? Was it sort of, yeah?
I think so. I
mean, more than a bit?
Yeah, it feels like a little bit, you know, chickens come home to roost.
So, in what sense?
In the sense of it's been associated, not entirely accurately, but it's very much been associated with the conservative court, a conservative movement to really expand the protections of the Second Amendment for gun owners. And here, of course, it kind of comes into conflict with the idea of, oh, we also...
I don't think that is what the host expected just then. This guy is anti-white. He just revealed that he's anti-white. He's like, ha ha, the chickens have come home to roost. You want citizens to be able to have self-defense? Well, now the illegals get to have self-defense. They won't stop at anything to have anybody but a proud, strong, heroic, intelligent white man as a representative, as a speaker. They'll pick any non-white, anti-white, bring them on to the program so that they can have an opinion that they hope they can kind of vector toward something they concur with. And then they can say, ah, we're legit as white people because this non-white guy agrees with us.
So I have to include this big issue with...
You said that the Congress might have to do its job, right? Flores was here illegally, therefore he broke a U.S. law.
Ken Folks said, the guy's from Wuhan.
I mean, and by Spain. So this is that the Second Amendment applies without Congress amending the law. So Congress could pass a law tomorrow that says illegal immigrants cannot have weapons, period.
Right.
And that would fix this situation.
I think so, yeah. I mean, I would agree. You have me in funny positions. I'm agreeing with Clarence Thomas, too. But I think he's exactly right.
It's a funny position that he's agreeing with Clarence Thomas. He's anti-white. That's who they brought on.
It's this presumption. The Constitution creates that presumption that whether you're legal here or not.
This is probably one of those Asian guys that... when they discriminated against a couple of Asian people here or there while discriminating against white people in order to get more blacks and Hispanics and Arabs in, when they did that, the Asians went berserk. You can't discriminate against, you can't. They didn't say a word about the discrimination against white people. Not a word. No problem with the discrimination against white people. Not a single thing to say about that. You can't include us in that discrimination group of white males. No different from reading that article by Jew in the City, where she actually complained that Jews who look like white males can't get work in Hollywood. Why? Because they look like white males. Not a word said about what it's actually really immoral and unjust to discriminate against white males on the basis of their birth.
Have that right as a person here. But if the specific law says you're not allowed to possess it because of your status or a crime you've committed, then that would fix the presumption.
All right. Andrew Roberts, I thought, rightly pointed out, he's one of our star producers, that you've got a lot of these cases in different courts. So it probably ends up at the Supreme Court at one point or another. But often...
And think again. When you heard this dickless Kendall with his nice hair say that, did you feel a sense of relief? Your sense of relief is superficial and ephemeral, because these nodes of power, like the Supreme Court, that's all that's left, are disappearing to us. They're held by anti-whites. So what's going to happen when the Supreme Court is no longer a node of power that white people and good non-white people who stand with us can rely upon for redress? Then imagine that world that we're going to live in. Imagine it. They are going to throw away the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. They're going to chuck everything. White men wrote it. It's got to go.
Sometimes these district judge rulings and everything else play into other cases. And if you, as the left is sort of chuckling and saying, hey, this serves Second Amendment activists, right? They're also saying, look, that these kinds of rulings then play into driver's licenses and whether the driver's license of a California resident who's an illegal alien is valid in Texas. How does that play out now?
That is really the tension with the federalism system. You obviously have situations in many areas of the law where the states have like this patchwork of differing kinds of decisions. And the Supreme Court, I think, it's hard to tell when they're willing to nationalize something. They're clearly willing to do it in the election context
right.
here. But for something like this, I think they're going to keep punting to Congress, which, as you're kind of suggesting, means that nothing may happen.
Thanks for watching.
Okay. So, Flores and the guy we were looking at before, they'll be able to have a firearm obtained illegally, and they'll be able to use it. And that's all legal. Your right to self-defense as a Westman, man, woman, or young adult, is continually under attack so that you can't defend yourself. And we see they're going to be coming to the houses. Do you really think, when you see them talking about invading the houses, do you really think they won't vote to take the houses away from us? Looks like the 11, 12-year-old Jason was right all along. Where are all the white people that are supposed to follow genuine white leadership? One more news item, and we're going to start the Twitter space. Donald Trump, not going to be able to pay. Not going to be able to pay, according to his lawyers. What's going to happen? Is he going to be jailed? Is he going to end up being jailed? And therefore, they will prevent him from being able to get out on the campaign trail? I'll pull that up on the screen. And we will take a look at the financial gifts that we have right now. Get out your raucous emojis, ladies and gentlemen. 007s, quadruple 07s, 96s, 96s with gems. Gems, and is there whipped cream? Is a banana split for this guy? Find some emojis that are tasty for dude, bro, moment. Who's financially gifted 50 white well-being dollars, and he says it, ladies and gentlemen, for white well-being. Gotta love Jason. He's there first with the 07s for this hero. Make sure he feels the love, ladies and gentlemen. He is here every single time we stream, and he is financially gifting. He's in service to white well-being, a glorious champion. Dude bro moment. Dude bro moment. Make sure you say his name. Say his name. Dude bro moment. That Franklin did. Thank you so much. And thank you to everybody who saw it. Keep the raucous emojis going, ladies and gentlemen, for another champion. You know him well. He is endlessly active for white well-being. It is no white guilt calypso. No white guilt clips. Financially gifting tonight, just like he did the other day. 100 saluting dollars. Please show him some love. Show him some love. All of us here are working class people. These are meaningful dollars to us. Please celebrate. Please show the love. I love the rhinos that Franklin broke out. I love the ice cream. Oh, there you did. Biospirit of the West came through. He's got cake. He's got ice cream. He's got banana splits. He's got lollipops. He's got, I don't know what the other one is there. Wonderful. God bless you. Thank you. Feed these people. Feed them. Feed them. Let's make sure their bellies are full. Donuts. Biospirit of the West came out. Feed them delicious. Do they got pizza? Is there a steak? Do they even allow that? Is there a steak? Maybe you could put a cow if they don't have an actual slab of steak. Delectable steak. for these heroes. God bless these two champions. We also have the great, the one and only, keep it going for Promethean Healing. Promethean Healing, God bless you. Big salutes. Feed him with 96s, ladies and gentlemen. 96s, the nine words, the six key concepts. Promethean Healing, financially gifting $20 over here on Subscribe Star. He says, Loralee is a hidden gem. You have so many great folks on that I never see anywhere else. Thank you, good brother. Well, God bless you for that, Promethean Healing. Thank you so much for all that you do in service to White Wellbeing, including financially gifting. You are a true gentleman and hero. Peacocks. Peacocks. Franklin has unleashed the reality that he is a peacock farmer. And everywhere this man goes, he's got like a peacock on each shoulder. Think about that, how impressive that is when the fans open up, when you have a big peacock on each shoulder. Truly an amazing thing. God bless this champion. And really a big thank you to everybody who is celebrating them. That's what we have to do. We have to celebrate folks who are active in service to White Wellbeing, making it happen, because no one else is going to celebrate. No one else is going to celebrate. I mean, you could head on over to one of the other communities and you all can celebrate an accomplishment that you had nothing to do with. You know, you better believe that when Trump wins, if it's not stolen, that they're all going to be celebrating that as their victory. We'll be celebrating, not as our victory, though, but we'll be celebrating. God bless you all. Let me have a look over here on DLive. It looks like we have a diamond. I think this might have been from the other day. We have a diamond, but I don't think I got to it, from Spartan. Ah, diamonds worth of cryptocurrency, a ninja diamond. And he wrote with it, Ireland for the Irish, Europe for white people. Well, amen. Thank you for that. There's no other way. There is no Europe without white people. There is no Ireland without white people. There is no America without white people. That's a fact. It's Western civilization. It's not a place on a map. It's in us, in our souls. It's our instinct. All right. Nobody over here on Odyssey. So we'll go ahead and keep rolling. And tag me as No White Guilt if you have something for me to read. But otherwise, Trump, his lawyers say, cannot pay the bond in New York.
Which is leading from behind for the Joe Biden administration. It's leaving Americans behind.
Yeah. Rebecca Heinrichs, Morgan Ortegas, great to have you both on. Thank you. Meantime, defense attorneys for former President Trump say that securing an almost $500 million bond for his civil fraud case is a practical impossibility, which means there is now a possibility that the New York Attorney General could begin seizing properties next Monday. The senior national correspondent, Kevin Cor.
Okay, so y'all remember, I had not read this case, but the judgment, but I correctly assumed that they wanted liquidity, that they weren't going to allow him to like pledge properties or something like this in lieu of actual dollars. And that appears to be the case. So they want $500 million. I'm open to being corrected on that, but
New York is live with the very latest on this. Kevin, good evening.
Evening, Trace. To hear the New York Attorney General tell it former President Trump is a potential scofflaw who must be held at bay by way of a more or less $500 million bond. And as incredible as that sounds, that's what passes for law in the state of New York at this time.
It's everywhere, and it's a consequence of anti-whiteism, and it's going to be like that everywhere. This is essentially a judge saying that I'm taking control of your house and you can have it back, but you have to sell it to get it back.
Quote, there is significant risk that absent a full bond or deposit, defendants will attempt to even.
Kind of interesting, isn't it, that you have this Letitia and she's very reminiscent of Fanny, very reminiscent of the judge we just looked at.
Evade enforcement of the judgment or to make enforcement more difficult after an appeal. So there's that. And with that, What some critics have called a legal travesty continues to play out in real time for the country to see. But it's a fight not only worth fighting, according to the former president, he's fully prepared to stake his future on it.
This was a rigged trial by a crooked judge and a crooked attorney general, and we're fighting it out with them. We have a lot of cash and we have a great company, but they want to take it away, or at least take the cash element away.
They do want to take it away. Now, the former president's lawyers say he can't secure the nearly $500 million bond in his civil fraud case, writing in a court filing that it was a practical impossibility under the circumstances presented. Now, this, of course, could mean the AG, Letitia James, who brought the case, could seek to freeze some of his bank accounts and, as you pointed out, Trace, perhaps even seize some of his properties.
So, yeah, she has the authority to seize his cash and freeze his accounts, seize his property. That's where we are. It's not a win to say, why, that's socialism. It's not a win to say, why, that's fascism. And the darn Dems, they're the real fascists. It's not a win. What we do is you can take this information and you introduce concepts from the Go Free practice for yourself and for your audiences. That's all that can be done.
Now, for those of you,
and that's everything. Because changing that moral imperative releases our people to take steps where they are with the power, wealth, intelligence, etc., that they have against anti-whiteism.
Watching the calendar carefully, the bond is due next Monday. Mr. Trump has, of course, asked an appeals court to pause that judgment, $454 million worth, or to accept a $100 million cash bond, Trace.
Kevin Cork, live for us in D.C. Kevin, thank you. Let's bring in criminal defense attorney and federal litigator Vic Bajaj. Vic, great to have you on. Andy.
Well, another brain to come in and tell us at the white-watched Fox News. It's almost like a theme, isn't it? I'm sure there aren't any white guys to ask. I mean, sometimes it just gets so wearisome. These people they're living good lives, folks. They're living happy. The winds are all in their sails. The anti-whiteism it elevates all their ships. Doesn't matter how they work, what their talents are. You're non-white or a woman, and that's your ticket to a better life. Now, it doesn't mean that every non-white person and every woman are going to either have the wherewithal or the intelligence or the ability or the drive to take advantage. I mean, all you have to do if you are a woman or a non-white is just tip forward. And the gravity of anti-whiteism will take you on to far more than you would have ever been able to do in life. Trust that. That's all you have to do. Just tip forward. Let the gravity take you. White males, there's nothing you can do. Nothing.
McCarthy made the argument that Trump might have a remedy. He said this, watch.
So as long as they're confident that he doesn't divest himself of what holdings he has, and it's not like there are other victims who are holding the bag here that were proved up at the trial who need to be compensated, the court ought to be satisfied that, you know, Trump's appeal could go through.
What do you think about that? You agree?
Well, the court ought to be satisfied, yes, but under the law, the judgment amount that was rendered in the superior court here by the judge needs to be honored and paid. So the reason for this in the background, Trace, is we don't want people to appeal judgments just because they can't pay. And so there has to be some evidence of ability to pay first. Now, what he is saying,
does it all have to come in? Do you have to get the whole $476 million?
You have to have someone who's willing to post it. And therefore, we have the bond. The insurance underwriting companies say, hey, if I can see you have a certain number of millions of dollars, I'll post the rest because, hey, you're good for it. Yep. The problem is there's both a factual dispute in this case, whether it was true, reasonable, or an abuse of discretion as to the amount of the $350 million plus interest. And also, there's a constitutional issue. Is this unreasonable under the law? Does it have a bearing?
Could you imagine anywhere else having such injustice inflicted and then having these superficial little dotting the T, crossing the I conversations about whether or not it's legitimate here or legitimate there, and not just calling this out for what it is. This is an entire lifetime of listening to this way of losing to the anti-whites.
A resemblance to the quote-unquote fraud that did not hurt anyone. So no. Therefore, you may have a federal issue and you may have a concurrent state issue.
Wall Street Journal says the following: whatever his transgressions, defendants are entitled to due process, which includes the right to appeal. Ms. James is trying to short-circuit the justice system to get Mr. Trump, as she promised she would during the 2018 campaign. I mean, is it time for another court to step in, Vic, and maybe make their presence known?
Beyond a shadow of a doubt, absolutely.
It was obviously time for this court and these people to recuse themselves for a long time because of these statements. But they don't abide by our rules and laws and customs and mores. They white erase all of that.
Absolutely. When you have a district attorney who's running for an elected position saying, I'm going to get X, Y, and Z. Imagine being X, Y, and Z if you're innocent. Imagine being X, Y, and Z if you're criminally culpable.
Is he going to come out with, he won't because he's non-white, but if he were white, he would say, imagine this happening to a black man.
But imagine if you can just relate to X, Y, and Z. And now these people have said, I'm going to elect you. So she needs to make good on her promise. Win, lose, or draw. If it's a weak case, you can bet your bottom dollar she was still going to limp through without a jury and only a judge. Yes, another court will get involved in this case. I believe we'll see action even from the New York State Supreme Court, but especially from the federal circuit courts.
Quickly, here's George Stephanopoulos and Nancy Mace back on March 10th. Watch.
You've endorsed Donald Trump for president. Judges and two separate juries have found him liable for rape and for defaming the victim of that rape. How do you square your endorsement of Donald Trump with the testimony we just saw?
It's a shame that you will never feel, George.
Stephanopoulos got it wrong. Does Trump have a case to sue him?
You know, when you have individuals who are public figures or celebrities, there's a real high level, a threshold. You have to show over and above what you would normally.
Yeah, and they're going to allow anybody to allege and state anything they want about somebody like Trump who gets in the way of anti-whiteism. Meanwhile, somebody who is an anti-white, like Stephanopoulos, they're going to be allowed to slide. We've seen this our whole lives. There's nothing new to this. There's no use in crying over it or in having another endless stream of non-white talking head professionals to come in and explain it for all us dumb white people. Just all we need is endless non-white people to come in and tell us, hey, white people, this is how this is how it is. You just don't seem to understand. The other, you got it on Fox, and then you got it on the other, that other station as well that people will recommend watching instead of Fox. All right, we're going to have a Spaces. You can talk about Trump not being able to post bond. What's going to happen to him? They can put you in jail, right? So is that what's going to happen? Are they going to arrest Trump? Talk about election interference. Is that what's going to happen? You could talk about the criminal intruders and how they're able to be armed, but we aren't. And you can talk about all that when we come back in just a moment. I want you to reach out in love. I want you to let those brothers and sisters around the base, let them know that even though the anti-whites wield so much power, that we are winning every contest with them, and that it's only a matter of time. Tell them that they can be more than they are. Tell them that they can stand up for Western kind, Western civilization, and everyone who lives in Western civilization of all immutable characteristics. Tell them that there's a way that they can stand up for it in love with the moral high ground. Be gentle with them at first. Coming out of a story that you thought was the real world is one of the hardest things that folks can do. If you go there with a true spirit and a true heart, with humility, you're going to win more souls than you'll ever turn away. And in the end, all of that will redound to the glory of our people and the reclamation of our destiny. And we are back, and the space is up and running if you would like to participate. We'll see about participation. You can also talk about Loralee and her really first last asking, did I check Cash App? I did the one time, but we can check it again right now. Let's have a look and see what we have over on Cash App. Well, wouldn't you know it? We have First Laz has appeared over there on Cash App. God bless this, sir. He has financially gifted $5, and he says, you are a great leader. Well, thank you. I really appreciate that, man. I really do. And if you listen to Loralee, she would say that you're able to conclude that because you have found the king within yourself. So thank you so much. I really appreciate that. First Laz. Darth Biden is with us. Who else do we have here? Remember to tag me as No White Guilt with any questions or comments or otherwise financially gift. I will see your financial gift and speak to that. Once you are on the Twitter space, you can ask for the microphone and we can talk about the items that we covered here on this roll-in. What do you think would happen if Donald Trump, well, first, I guess the question is, are they going to try to arrest him? Are they going to go ahead and arrest him since he can't come up with the cash for the bond? We know that it doesn't matter how heinous a crime is by an anti-white. They're not even reproved, much less castigated or imprisoned, given a fine of $500 million. They're not even reproved. But when it comes to somebody who's going to get in the way of anti-whiteism, intentionally or unintentionally, this is the kind of consequences that they end up facing. Will they try and actually arrest Donald Trump? And if they did that, what would be the outcome of that? How would that play out? Would Donald Trump submit to that? Would he allow himself to be jailed? Wouldn't he have to? What would be the consequences of refusing to be arrested, refusing to turn himself in, staying away from New York and any of the states that might try to arrest him and extradite him to New York? What would be the consequences of that? What kind of a power play might be afoot at the moment when it comes to Trump's awareness that to arrest him is to interfere in the election, which is a crime, and their desire to interfere in the election? Letitia, we have a request for microphone, and let's see. It's Western Kind United. I will give you the mic, and then you can unmute when you see that you have the microphone and let us know what's on your mind about that or the other topics we were talking about during this roll-in. And I will keep an eye out across all of the different platforms for people who are tagging me with questions and comments.
How's it going today, brother?
Good, man. How you doing?
It's going all right. I just got done exercising the dogs.
Nice.
All right. I have composed a little idea on this matter. So we were witness more lawfare and more conversion of the institutions created by Western Kind into weapons used to bludgeon us. Trump will not be spared anything.
Right.
They will put him in a cage if they can.
Yeah, I agree with that. they can get away with it.
But this will be a double-edged sword, because on one end, they will have the satisfaction of saying, oh, look, we put him in the cage. We have him humbled. But on the other end, other people are going to witness this, and they are going to comprehend the immensity of the corruption and the disintegration of our systems, and they will be able to reference this. It is visible. It is too high profile.
Yeah, and I think that, I mean, that's what we have been witnessing with the invasion of Mar-a-Lago, the booking and the photographing, and just the filing of the charges. Every time the persecution rises, the temperature is increased on Donald Trump, more people favor him, more people come to defend him. And so, yeah, it's definitely a double-edged sword. They would have to, I mean, if you think about it in that sense, since it's so beneficial to Trump and MAGA, every time there's another charge or another arrest or what have you, every time that happens, since it always redounds to his benefit, they would have to do something really extreme to try to overcome the massive benefit to Trump. And I don't know if anybody has a thought on what that might be, but certainly imprisoning him and maybe even like solitary would be something that would be extreme that the state could get away with. Any thought on that, brother? Otherwise, you can just keep the mic and stay muted. We have another request for Mike.
Oh, I was just thinking that perhaps that he can lose a couple of pounds in such a case.
He could lose a couple pounds. Yeah, Holly. I mean, wouldn't it be something to have Trump locked up, solitary confinement, we can't see or hear from him, and then he wins the election?
Those that are in the control of the institutions of power, that they have decided that he is just going to be of utility, that they are going to allow this little release valve of pressure, I think that he's probably going to be permitted to win.
Let's hope. I guess we'll see here as the year rolls forward how much worse it ends up getting for Trump. Or, you know, if they drop back on some of these charges, on some of this pressure. I was earlier in a space on Twitter, and I shared that an article last month detailed how in 2022, the DNC changed their rules so that if a candidate, it's a strange timing. It's almost as if it's, you know, perfect timing. That if a candidate drops out or dies, the DNC just gets to arbitrarily decide who the candidate will be for the Democrats. So that was an interesting little piece of information. I hope I'm understanding it correctly. Check it out for yourself. But that seems to be an interesting timing for, well, if our candidate dies or drops out, then the behind the scenes people can just decide who the new candidate will be. We have another request for Mike. Let's see who that is. Andrew. All right, Andrew, giving you the microphone. When you see that you have it, you can unmute and share with us your thoughts. Ken Folks says, Loralee was great and can't wait to hear from her again. I know, either can I. She was marvelous.
Yeah, I think all those options that you were saying could be on the table, and of course they are. It's reality. There is a possibility that they put them in jail in New York, and it would be like the state rights of New York versus the federal government and stuff. I thought of something kind of funny when you were talking about what they might do, how funny and ironic or whatever would it be that if they, I think it would be more likely that they would like seize his Trump Tower property in New York, right, or whatever, they pretty much already kicked him out of New York City and everything. What if they put like migrants inside of Trump Tower? That would just be, it's not off the table. I don't think that would just be, but that would be funny.
Yeah, I think they would do that. That's the mentality of anti-whites is indeed to crush you and then rub your face in it. And so I could see them doing that, seizing Trump Tower. And again, isn't it such a salient example of what happens with Western kind? We build glorious Western civilization. Here's this guy, a builder, and builds beautifully. And then it's stolen by thieves, by people who hate the white race. And they're composed of people of all races. They steal it and ruin it. So I could see, yeah, absolutely, them doing something like that. But you, I mean, who knows if these, so many of these illegal intruders are going to even remain in New York or Chicago, where they have been shipped by Texas and other states, but primarily by Texas, because you can see with Tyson Food, they are shipping them to Tennessee to work in their factories there after firing all of those people. And what was it, Iowa?
Closing down the plant.
Yeah. And then there were some people online saying, oh, it was all just non-white people up at that other plant. No, it wasn't. They interviewed a bunch of people, and everybody that I saw interviewed were white people who had worked there, and they were talking about how they came in that morning and they were just their normal happiness and expecting another week. And then they were handed a little slip of paper that said, all right, your job is done. And ultimately meaning the town is done. That little town's not going to be able to survive the factory shipping out to Tennessee and employing far more of these illegal intruders than they fired in that little town. Anything else you want to share, brother? If not, you can just hold on to the mic and mute yourself.
Like two other points, kind of cool. Similar to anti-whitism, just how backwards and upside down things are nowadays. They talk about minorities and everything, but if you look at the world population, we are like less than 10%, maybe 7% of the world population.
Absolutely. So
we are the only minority pretty much in the world. Indians, Asians, Latin Americans, Africans, they all have a billion people. Mm-hmm. And so we are the only minority in the world. And they're trying to flip this and call other people minorities in our own countries. And then, like, October 7th, they said, like, 1,200, 1,700 Jewish people died. We have like 100,000 plus in the USA alone dying every year, and we don't do anything that the Jews were doing in response, like they are now.
Oh yeah, yeah, without question. And to your point, I know you got another point, but I just want to mention that.
No, that was both of them. Both of them.
All right, cool. Yeah, you can stick around. The word minority is what we refer to here in the practice of Go Free as a meme pathogen. So in other words, it's a concept that is part of a psychological warfare that is called anti-whiteism that is inflicted on the totality of the West, which is why we have the same outcomes and the same agenda in every single Western country. And this particular word is used to instill a sense of weakness and fragility and lack of harm and et cetera for non-white people. And thereby instilling the opposite for white people: power, the ability to harm, the inability to be victimized. So that's why you never use the words that our victimizers give us. That is what so many people have a hard time understanding, because they think in their arrogance that consciously they can say, oh no, well, I know what it means. I know what it means. But what they're failing to understand is what the psychological warfare operators understand, that we live our lives, the vast majority of our lives, in our subconscious mind. And as a consequence, what we learn, principally through entertainment, but also a little bit through education, principally through entertainment, what we learn about the world and what minority means and all of those moments on those TV shows or in those books when we were with the minority in their solitude and they were crying and they were innocent and they were wrongly put upon, all of that is invoked for these people. And who were they put up, who was wrongly putting upon them? Well, it was evil white people, almost always white guys with Germanic features like mine, light colored eyes like mine, high forehead like mine, almost always. And so that ends up being the way they control the human animal. Yeah, it's unreal that it, unfortunately, that it takes at least a little bit higher than a midwit IQ to comprehend, even to be able to put these dots together and comprehend how it actually happens. And that this indeed is a superior understanding of our victimization than anything else. Because the midwittery and the midgetwittery, they are beyond stolid. They can't be moved at all. They're like the dumbest mule, and that's decided to be as irascible and uncooperative as you can imagine. And it doesn't matter how many carrots you hold in front of it, cattle prod at its ass, the thing is just not moving. So we have to grapple with the reality that all of our institutions, all of our religions, all of our alma mater have been undermined by this psychological warfare. It was designed and is continually designed to undermine those things. So none of it has survived, which means we can't turn to any of it to push back against our victimization. In and of itself, it can play a part, but the primary item of our resistance is the practice that undermines the psychological warfare used against us, and that is the go-free method. I'm looking here on Twitter. I don't see any comments, nobody tagging me that has a question or something worth bringing up for our... Go ahead.
Have you been listening to iHypocrite recently?
Say that again?
Have you been listening to iHypocrite recently?
No, I haven't.
He's been attempting to resuscitate, to reclaim the word racist.
Oh, God. That's too bad.
He has some interesting streams. He has some humorous stuff, but yeah, he's been attempting to recapture, to restore the word, and I just wanted to hear your reactions. All right.
Thank you for letting me know. I really like him. And every time, you know, the few couple times that I've chatted with him, I really like him. And what I've watched of his streams a while back now, I haven't had an opportunity to catch recently and see this, what is, in my opinion, a blunder. But I like the guy, and I would like him to stop. If this is what he's doing, I'd like him to abandon what will, with 100% certainty, be a failed effort to redefine the concept racist. In fact, using the concept racist, the central concept of anti-whiteism and the anti-white immoral moral imperative, which is our social morality across the West. That's the social morality. Every time you use it, you make it stronger to harm us. Every time you use it, you enable it to pull down more of Western civilization. The definition for the word race, and this is an example of what I was just talking about. Thank you for bringing that up. That in our hubris of our conscious mind, we could say, like, we could get into a circle of five people and say, okay, well, for this conversation, we're going to say that racist means what it means in the dictionary, for example, or what's written at least there for now, and in some dictionaries we've seen where now they say these definition of racist, it can only be in the rule books, the dictionary can only be applied to white people, but more importantly, the rule book is not what matters. So if we are in a circle of five and we say, okay, racist is going to mean just anybody of any race feeling that they're superior to or etc. of another race, or believing negative things about the totality of another race, we can do that. consciously, but that's the weakness of it. That's the weakness of the conscious mind, because the definition of racist exists in the minds of the hundreds of millions of people across Western civilization, the people we're concerned about. And in those cases, it means something that white people do. Try to really grapple with the subtlety that a person can both know that racist, the concept racist in a dictionary means X, Y, and Z, and then operate and experience their lives in their subconscious mind, where they have endless iterations, endless examples of white people harming non-white people, and that, and innocent non-white people, and that being the definition of racism. So those two things can operate together. And it's the subconscious mind that ends up governing our lives. And as a consequence, we see that racist has been institutionalized at the state, county, and federal level, defined as something that white people do. And more importantly, they don't even have to actually write into the verbiage just white people, because they know that it ipso facto means white. It's just like when people say, why didn't the founding fathers of America just like write 20 times that this is for white people every time they wrote our posterity? Why didn't they do that? Well, because it was a given. It was taken for granted. Of course, this is what we're talking about. Who would ever think otherwise? That is how racist, the concept racist and racism functions in the global population. To try to redefine one of our victimizers' concepts. Remember, if you use their concepts, you legitimize their ideology. That is a precept of psychological warfare, which it targets the white populations of the West. It is akin to historical revisionism, where you're going to tell people, no, it doesn't mean that, it actually means this. Well, that has never worked. And people have tried for a very long time to, you know, take back concepts from the anti-whites, and it's totally impossible. It is totally impossible because you can't communicate in the endless iterations of entertainment media over the course of the entirety of the population's lives this new definition. So instead, you need concepts, as we have formulated here, that don't require the audience to go look it up, that don't require them to need an extensive training, that don't require them to have endless reams of entertainment to educate them about how they're supposed to feel. And because in the psychological warfare, these concepts aren't delivered sterilely in the entertainment or in education or infotainment. They're always delivered with emotion. What you're supposed to feel and understand and know about the victim, feel, understand, and know about the victimizer. You can't replace all of that. It's a very foolish thing, but I do understand for content creators wanting to keep an audience and grow an audience and et cetera, that if that's the language that they're going to speak and you want to continue a living from creating the content, then something like that is alluring, trying to use the language that they use and then say that, well, my purpose here is to redefine it. But I really like iHypocrite, and I was on with him. He had me on, God bless him, and 2 years ago, I guess it was now, a year and a half. And I shared with him a slew of information, sort of a data dump, so that he could review that interview as often as he needed to be empowered by these concepts and deliver that then and make a real difference in the world. And if I could say anything to him, I would ask him to review that interview and to take a pause and listen to what I've had to say here and see if there really is any chance of taking concepts away from anti-white and anti-whiteism, from anti-whites and the ideology anti-whiteism. Just utterly futile. And ultimately, it will do damage to us. One of the
one of the most pathetic things I think to witness, and if people, you know, they want to, if they're going to be honest, is seeing a white person screaming racist at somebody who's anti-white. It is akin to watching someone beat themselves, to flay themselves. It's akin to that. It's like they shout out, "I'm going to show you," and then they take a cat of nine tails or whatever it is, these different types of torture devices, and begin whacking themselves, splitting their flesh open. "I'm really going to show you this time. Let me split some more of my flesh open. Let me scar my body some more." So this sort of this is really frustrating for me to learn when people are doing that kind of a thing, because I've been at this for decades, and I have been without financial reward, not getting rich, definitely not getting famous or celebrated, definitely not extolled by masses of audience for telling people what will benefit them. So just year after year, day after day, month after month, week after week, decade after decade, telling people to my detriment what will benefit them, and it working for thousands of people, and still this intransigence, this utter bullheaded or pigheadedness that says, "Nope, I don't care how much it works for people. I don't care how logical it is. I don't care of how many pieces of evidence that you have that it has succeeded. Instead, I'm going to go down this path, remain in the anti-white narrative, and ignore the signs of failure." To see that everywhere is very frustrating for me, especially after people have had contact with me and this community and see the success we're having. So I'm sorry to hear that, especially since I like him so much. Hopefully he'll come around, because he has a great personality, and he is a talented content creator and a great delivery. So a lot of people will heed what he has to say. It's one of the reasons why we have another huge victory. We'll celebrate it on Sunday. Colossal victory of getting another content creator to adopt some of these concepts that we spread. And how do they adopt it? Not because we have the ability to force it onto the population, not because we have the ability to put it in all their entertainment, but because with intelligence, we have figured out how to undermine the psychological warfare that's used on us. And these tools are seen as valuable to people when they come across them, and they pick them right up and begin using them in their lives. So thousands of people, the practice has worked for. Why won't it work for you? We have, you know, at the same time, while people continue to revert to failed strategies and failed ideologies like hamsters on a wheel, we have these anti-white, non-white intruders that are essentially peripatetic. Their job now, they get our tax dollars, they get support. You could look at the billions of dollars of our labor. And that's the thing to really drive home a point about it being our labor, our ingenuity, that a bigger and bigger chunks of our year are labor, ingenuity, creativity, etc., go toward our white erasure, go toward our divestment, go toward all things that victimize us. So you have these, if you know peripatetic, it's like traveling for work. They get to travel, they get phones, they get money, they get healthcare, they get all of this. And check it out to make sure that I'm not inaccurate on those points. Maybe it's just my opinion. Maybe I'm being an entertainer. I am streaming on multiple platforms right now. But they get all of this, and then they can threaten and carry out home invasion and occupying, seizing homes from people. And who knows what else? I mean, when you have somebody who is engaged in that level of criminality, that's not the only criminal thing they're doing. There's going to be a great many other things that they are engaged in at the same time, not the least of which will be voting when they're not allowed to vote, or just being counted as another member of the population, so that the apportionment of congressional representatives increases in those areas that are anti-white. And then we end up with an anti-white House that can never be changed in the federal government. And the same will hold true for state governments over time. But you end up with this a anti-white control of the House forevermore. It won't matter how many people, white and good non-white people, vote for representatives who always do a piss poor job because they're anti-white to some degree or another, to go out and contend with this new strain and this new worsening strain of anti-whiteism. And the interpretations, the understanding of society is so wrong, and that's why we end up with the wrong answers so often, is so wrong outside of the study that we have engendered and embarked upon a long time ago and continue to update, is so wrong that I continue to see people share, like I saw tons of people sharing this Elon Musk tweet about how the idea that the weak are always good and the strong are always bad is why Jews now in Israel are being, and Jews maybe generally, are now being challenged by these anti-white, darker skinned non-whites than Jews. Well, that's just totally wrong. That's not it at all. And I've explained before how we get to a point where both white women are now being increasingly harmed by anti-whiteism, and increasingly Jews, especially as Jew in the City pointed out in Hollywood, if they look very white, then this anti-white system that rolls along, a phenomenon that is increasingly darker skinned, increasingly brown and black and et cetera, yellow, what have you, that they want to call themselves, increasingly can target the white women, don't need them anymore, increasingly can target Jews, just throw them in with the group of white people if they look white to them. That's how we get here. So if we have a correct understanding of the world and the challenges that we face, we can formulate correct responses. That's why it would be miraculous if Musk actually wanted to make a difference and would end up heeding what we share here. It probably wouldn't take many conversations with him to make enormous changes in the kinds of things that he says and therefore legitimizes, and therefore the change in the conversation that takes place across the West. And that change in that conversation means a change in how our victimization is discussed. That changes everything. That's the only way, and in fact, it's brilliant, but it's the only way to change our plight. There isn't going to be any army. There isn't going to be any violent resistance. There isn't going to be any voting way out of this. None of those other things are going to work. I would think that people coming across this community, white people who really wanted, and good non-white people, and we have wonderful white and non-white people here in service to white well-being opposing anti-whiteism. I would think that every single one, if they were thinking people, would, in seeing the successes here and seeing the articulation, would think, okay, this is it. I have found this works. Nobody else has, like, for example, iHypocrite, he won't have one jot of success at reclassifying, redefining racist. None. He'll have zero success. But his audience won't care. His audience will just go right along with it. And just like you look over at this Owen Benjamin, and this guy is half Jewish, married to a non-white Hispanic, and has non-white children. But you have this slew of white people that rally around him and follow him and watch everything he does. We had Loralee speak a little bit to that, and how ill the white race is spiritually. and therefore they can't find the king or the queen inside themselves. And if they can't find the king or queen inside themselves, then they can't identify genuine leaders for Western kind. We got a request for Mike, and I will pass it over in just one moment. If you have a comment or question for me, you can tag me as No White Guilt across any of these platforms. You may also still financially gift if you so desire, but otherwise tag me as No White Guilt with a question or comment, and we will speak to it while we are together. We have, is that Netflix? Netflix Morality. All right. That sounds interesting. It's an interesting name. When you get the mic, you can unmute and share your thoughts.
Yeah. Hey, Jason, longtime listener, first time caller. I really appreciate everything you do. I think it's brilliant.
And, thank you.
I just had an idea I wanted to mention as far as a meme curative that okay. I was coming across. So, you know, before I started kind of following all of this, when I would hear something, just an off comment or see something in media that I could tell was anti-white, but I didn't really know how to respond to it, or I could tell it bothered me, but I didn't really know how to respond to it. So, but, you know, just thinking about when someone maybe says a comment that they wouldn't say about another race, but they feel comfortable saying it because of the anti-white narrative. So, you know, you start off saying, okay, well, why are you taking shots at me and my ancestors and my descendants? You wouldn't do that about another race. I wouldn't do that about you. But, you know, if they respond in a way that shows that they are dismissive of it, if they seem like they don't care and they say, oh, they are dismissive of, you know, the possibility that whites could be victimized, then you say, well, your inability or your unwillingness to accept that whites could be victims shows that you view the world through an anti-white lens. You view things through an anti-white lens, and that's proof. So I just want to see what you think about that.
I love it. Yeah, without question. You immediately turn it around on them and enforce them to defend whether or not they're anti-white, and they're going to own that, and they are going to try to give reasons. That's a wonderful place to put them, because then they're in an immoral position and you're in the moral position. Otherwise, they'll have to try to deny being anti-white, which is a wonderful position to put them in, because then we decide what the bar is for what they have to do, what they have to say to not be anti-white. And of course, in this scenario, as you're pointing out, brother, and I really like it. Well, this is a great meme curative. What you're pointing out here is that when they're in that position and you're deciding how far they have to go to prove that they're not anti-white by saying, hey, you wouldn't do this to a non-white group of people, you're only going to do it to white people, that immediately changes that conversation to favor the end of our victimization. And that's what our interactions have to do with both adversaries and friends and family who, or strangers who are not being adversarial, who we want to bring over to a state of mind that puts an end to our victimization. So it's very well stated. And thank you so much for calling in and being a longtime listener, brother. And you're welcome to call in anytime we have these spaces.
Sure. Yeah. And I just had one other quick question. I know you had the success with the iHeartRadio or whatever it was, where they had the false advertising, or they made the wrong image when that little girl was attacked on the bus, and you got them to change that.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, when, let's say, just, you know, when we come across examples in the real world, for example, I see a lot of things on YouTube where it's, you know, has like for preteens and have tens of millions of views, and it's like anti-white Karen discriminates against a black person. So these are like not satirical, but they're, you know, skits of the, but so, you know, you see these types of things. And again, that's an example where they would never use that type of language for another group in the title, or it would be immediately flagged and taken down. So What do you think is the best way in those scenarios where we see that? How do we put pressure on these organizations to say, hey, that's, you know, again, you're presenting as in an anti-white way, the way that you're, you know, allowing certain content to stay up, or you're, you know, portraying things in a certain way. What's the best way to put pressure on them?
That's a great question. And it depends on, I think, to a large degree, on the platform, regrettably, because it's certainly a YouTube isn't going to listen to any. I mean, they are just going to be anti-white to the end of the day. We can make these appeals, though, in all cases. And one of the ways that we encourage in the book, Go Free, to what we refer to as facing anti-whiteism. It just means that when we see it, we face it and we think about how it's anti-white and what kind of responses we can formulate. And to practice the method of Go Free, we can then engage. And so, for example, we can have a local newspaper might be a place that if you see something like this and they write about a Karen, you can write out a response. It can be digital, of course, but you can also mail it in. Write out a response about saying exactly what you just said there. You would never do this. You would never use a common non-white name as a pejorative. And so this is anti-white, and I would very much appreciate that you don't behave in this immoral way and that you never use this anti-white terminology again for one of the names of my people. Articulating this kind of thing from the position of morality, from the position of firmness. We're firm. We're saying this is it. We're not going to tolerate this. You're professional. You don't have to be fanatical. You use just everyday speech so that your audience will understand exactly what you're saying, and you'll end up getting, it won't be all the time. It's certainly, like I say, with like a YouTube or something like that. But you will end up getting the outcomes that we desire, which is the end of our victimization. It's entirely possible that if there are enough of us on Twitter and we are practicing Go Free, and we are, when we see these sorts of things, we're objecting, we're reaching out to Twitter and we're saying, this is wrong, this is anti-white, this is immoral, it shouldn't be permitted on the platform, that eventually it would influence the application of the rules on Twitter. And we have coming up this weekend, brother, by the way, Yiz the Unifier had another huge victory at a store. So Real World was able to go to the store using the lexicon and interacting with the management there and got them to change a poster that they had up at the store. So these are things that, as you're referencing here with the iHeartRadio, that we can absolutely effectuate in the real world. We had Heidi. I don't know, brother, if you've been around to hear about Heidi's story, where she her son was given an anti-white book to read. She had to read to the little boy so that he could do a report on it. She called the principal. She called the teacher. She had a meeting with them. She went in there. She talked about how it was anti-white, how it was going to victimize her son, how it made white children look bad. And the teacher said in response to that, you're right. It is anti-white. Now, she's not a follower of what we're doing here. But she might become that. She said, yes, you're right. It is anti-white. I'm getting rid of the book. Not only does your little boy not have to read it anymore, I'm taking it out of the lessons and protecting all white children as a consequence. Now,
yeah.
To take it to the next level, brother, is if we get the kind of funding that other big entities get so that we can effectively become like a white ADL, then we can exert a lot more influence. I would be able to personally reach out, as I did with iHeartRadio, and put pressure on them as the focal point or the vanguard for the totality of this community. And more importantly, as I did with iHeartRadio, give the accurate presentation that the totality of white people are going to find this objectionable. That's why iHeartRadio fixed it like that. They ended up looking and they said, you know what? It's going to be a lot easier to just change this picture than it is to deal with this guy using terminology that we know that normal white people are going to side with him against us because it's moral. So that's exactly what we have to do. But as we, maybe more specifically to your question, as we get to a point that we we get increasingly organized, we can, in a more targeted way, come together and put pressure on organizations the same way that anti-whites did in the past when America was 90%+ white. The same exact kind of way, institutional pressure, pressure of people showing up at the physical locations to sit down in their lobbies and make doing business difficult, all of that sort of thing. That's a great question, though, man. Thank you for reaching in.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Jason.
Oh, God bless you, brother. And you're welcome to come in on a Twitter space anytime you want. You can keep the mic and just mute yourself and jump in if you something else comes to mind. All right. Great question. And these conversations are always really productive conversations because we can talk more about in people's like lived experience interacting with anti-whites. We can get a little bit more into the nuts and bolts of how the concepts work, how the dialectics work, and how this is different from what's gone before, how this is different from the complaining, different from the endless ad nauseum conversations about, you know, who's behind it and all of this, and very different from the very superficial, low IQ takes of the past that essentially intoxicate mid and midget wit people. And then they show up with this great hubris to tell you how dumb you are because they, in their midget wittery, have it all figured out. So this is obviously a place where the conversations and the enlightenment, it's conducive to productivity in reclaiming our destiny, which is totally different from what we've seen. I extol, I cherish the people who are out there and who are, and especially those who are out there investigating the voting machines and the voting fraud, and all of that's got to be done for the short term elections that good people or semi-good people or are still engaged in. All of it's got to be done. But ultimately, that work was done and failed. Ultimately, all of those type of efforts are futile. It's putting your fingers in the cracks in the dam, and it's still coming over. The reason it's still coming over is because it's driven by a social morality, the anti-white immoral moral imperative. And so that we have to contend with, and that's what the practice overcomes. That's why we're able to change so many things here. You weren't able to go and have books taken out of the curriculum like you can, as we achieved. You make some sort of a power play in a county somewhere, a school district. You have a book taken out. Johnny has sex with his dog. You have that book taken out. And the anti-whites flood in, powered by that social morality. And lawsuits are filed, which go to juries, which go to judges, which go to county officials, which go to the state governing bodies that oversee school districts, where the people in those positions are either hardcore anti-white or otherwise, because it can't be any other way, infected by the psychological warfare that is anti-whiteism, and they get the results that they want. That's why you check into these Twitter spaces, and I was in one the other night, where these wonderful ladies, they were, you know, older ladies, and they were talking about the reality of we always lose. And then coming to these inane conclusions that, well, if they had to face a tough old woman like me, then they would back right down, because when you're a traitor to America, you're a coward. I mean, it sounds nice. And, you know, I want to applaud a woman that has that much gumption, especially in older and years of life, and wants to just take it on and take it out. But it's as futile as the way warfare was practiced in the past as it changed into trench warfare. You could imagine a military sitting in the trenches, which essentially the Confederate States of America did, and one of the reasons why they won so many battles, is when you had such a smaller population and with far fewer munitions, you had to find innovative ways to fight. And so they got in trenches and in many cases where they could, and benefited them greatly. It's that futile trying to take on anti-whiteism. You just gun to pieces.
Hey, Jason, I have a quick update for you.
Yeah.
You remember Cross Eyes on the Right?
Oh, yeah. Yes. Haven't heard that in a while.
Is E.T. White still on the job?
He's still on the job?
Whoever that it is, it may be male, maybe female. I'm getting more of a female from the writing style.
Okay.
But I was reading their article on your coverage of the ritualistic effacement of the statue of Robert E. Lee.
Ah.
One thing that I noticed in the article was that the author capitalized the J in the word Jew, but not the W in the word white. But anyway, this was just a quick update. Cross Eyes on the Right is still quite active and still as myopic as ever.
I'm gonna have to find the picture we have of him. Who made that? Did Fernal make that? I'm gonna have to look it up. But I see JK160 has joined us. Jay Bishop is here. DeNovo is with us. Great to see you all here at the round table, the white table, the knights, white knights of white well-being. Let's see, we have the all-seeing guy is also here with us. Remember to tag me as No White Guilt. We have the best people. You clearly see that. There is a weeding process. There is a self-selecting process, isn't there? When people show up to our community, it sounds very different from what they're used to. And people who are actively engaged in something that at first must seem quite arcane, but in reality is really easy to use, really easy to implement in your life, totally pragmatic. Everyone has jargon in their lives. It can be the sports, it can be their hobbies, and obviously their employment. And this is no different. In fact, that there's less jargon in the Go Free practice than there is in your employment. You need to learn a bunch of concepts, a bunch of words, names for tools, names for processes that you had no problem picking up. More importantly, you'll notice that the population has no problem picking up the deleterious, harmful concepts that anti-whites promulgate. If the anti-whites tomorrow could decide that they're going to promulgate a new name for themselves, they could call themselves, and I've joked about this in the past, they could call themselves like God's cherubs. And overnight, white people, good non-white people, will be referring to them as God's cherubs. And they'll say it with as much snark and sarcasm as they can muster, as though that somehow harms the anti-whites, as though somehow that instills in us some sort of righteous indignation for those who inflict injury on us. It simply does not. The same way that we saw and continue to see things like concepts like grooming gang being used. People ask all the time, how is it that you had groups of people that were abducting and raping, and the father would show up and then the father would get arrested and not the gang and not the rapist? Why wasn't there this big upsurge? Why didn't all these people come out? Folks, it's because of psychological warfare. It's because there are people in the governments of the West that are loyal to the structures, and they are implementing psychological warfare, and it's been going on long before, you know, the recent times when they have ruled, for example, here in the U.S., where they could use the military to implement the psychological warfare. They don't need that. It's been going on for a long time. It's a natural consequence of the weakness in us for this selfish individualism. That's where anti-whiteism festers. That's where it comes from. And then anybody can pick it up, take it, and use it to their benefit. And we had our own selfish individualists using anti-whiteism to their benefit and to our harm long before any other groups come in. Nobody's exonerated by this. No group of people, individual, or percentage of a totality of a people that use it to victimize us, they're not exonerated by the fact that anti-whiteism is a phenomenon and that it's a weakness in us that causes it to grow and to flourish. They're not exonerated by it because we're still victimized by it. We, though, have to take the accountability and responsibility. That's the big difference. And you know what I was thinking about this the other day? It was interesting. Is that we talk about putting an end to our victimization. And then you have these people who will come in from the white sympathetic sphere to slander us because, you know, we're not demonizing whatever their particular group of scapegoats might be that they want everybody to demonize. And we'll claim that we're the ones who are not taking responsibility for what needs to be said, when in reality, we are the only ones who are taking responsibility for what needs to be said and done. We're the only ones taking accountability because the people who come in, who have scapegoats and excuses, they are able to divest themselves of the accountability and responsibility by putting the blame on someone else, some other group of people. And as long as that other group of people, as long as this other thing is present, then our victimization continues. That is to do nothing. And that's another reason why we are a self-selecting community, because people who don't want the responsibility of recapturing our destiny immediately are chafed by the responsibility. They would rather a content creator tell them, it's not your fault. It's this other group of people. It's this bad club over here or over there. They meet in secret. They have all the money in the world. And there's nothing you can do about it except complain. And that's, unfortunately, too many of our people, a great many of our people. Hopefully it's not too many, but a great many of our people. That's exactly what they want to hear, unfortunately. But you can apply this to your own lives and you can see very easily what happens to a person who lives a life who says that their failures and their weaknesses, their inability, their state that they find objectionable in the world is everybody else's fault, or it's some other group of fault and they can't do anything as long as that other group is present. What does that end up doing to their lives? If instead, as we do here, you do in your own life, you take responsibility for all of it. Are you a drug addict? It's your fault. Or do you not have very much money? It's your fault. If you're always, now, it's obviously, this is adults who are reflecting upon challenges in our world. And there is an apportionment of blame and responsibility, but that does not give you, unless you want to remain in that state, that doesn't give you the out. That doesn't give you the option to surrender your responsibility to take charge of your life, to take charge of our situation, to put an end to our victimization. Because if it does, then nothing changes. So just like an individual life, we as a community have to come together and say, all right, it's on us. And we're going to make a change. I see that the great, who is that, Slots? I'm all blurry right now. Let's pass the mic over. And when you have the microphone, you can unmute and share your thoughts.
Hey, brother.
Hey, brother.
Oh, good. I can be heard.
Yeah.
I just, I dropped in really late, so apologies to everyone.
No worries.
Wasn't able to hear everything. But I wanted to speak to the gentleman's question about the anti-white slur Karen.
Mm-hmm.
And I only wanted to get on here and express that he's not alone in trying to wrangle with that term with the anti-whites and having difficulty with it, because there's been a kind of like the alt-light kind of thing, the vague. They have been using it to describe anti-white women. So it becomes very difficult to unseat that and at the same time validate what it is they're expressing criticism of. And so at this point, I mostly treat it as a cringe, and I do cringe at it whenever I hear it. And when it comes to rebuking it, I know most of the time it's just they've been caught up in the anti-white terminology and they're using it.
Right.
So I only wanted to express that he's not alone having difficulty with it. We're all having difficulty with it. And so we're just hanging on and doing what we can outside of it.
Right. Yeah, I would, when you come across it, if it's being used by someone who is marginally concerned with white well-being, white sympathetic sphere in general, just to, as you're saying there, like alt-right light, that term that used to be used for an entire swath or entire group of circles, is to say that, do you mean anti-white when you say this? And get their response, because if they actually mean anti-white, then that's a great opportunity to communicate that concept. And then to mention that, hey, look, this was given us by our victimizers. This Karen was given us because it's harmful. It's demonizing white people. I think that in many occasions when you see white people using Karen as a pejorative, as a cut down, it's used in the same way that white people will use Marxist or communist. Just they don't want to mention the white victimization because of that social morality, another proof of the social morality that we've been infected with. I mean, it's so interesting, I think, to sit back and to observe how easy it is, once you have the lens of the Go Free method, how easy it is to see the psychological warfare that is anti-whiteism afoot in the population and how easily it manipulates them. Once you're able to see anti-whiteism, the fact that white people won't mention our victimization as white people being victimized suddenly is like this supernova, this like beam in your eye. I mean, you can't see anything else around it. It would be like trying to see, you know, Venus beside the sun. It's just everything else gets blanked out by the proof that there is this social morality and that these people have been taught that their own victimization is immoral and therefore they don't mention it. This is the kind of conversation that needs to be had in the presence of Elon Musk. This is the kind of conversation that he has to participate in. If you've listened to the spaces where this poor guy has been surrounded by theologians and priests and rabbis and political commentators, and it's just this bewildering mistakes and confusion, and how could you possibly, as a consequence, come to something that would be effective for putting an end to our victimization and indeed effective for putting an end to his persecution by these people? There'll be nothing he can do since he's a white man. I mean, for the rest of his life, if he were to become radically anti-white, he would be given a pass because of the wealth that he would employ for anti-whiteism. You can think only of other billionaires, other millionaires, centimillionaires, decamillionaires who are anti-white. And even in the midst of the anti-white arguments about how evil it is that white people have wealth, and with the implication or outright statement that wealth is this great evil, they have no problem lauding and endorsing these billionaires, centimillionaires, decamillionaires who are anti-white. The very next moment, again, it's always a way, sort of a barometer to understand what is anti-white and anti-whiteism,
is these the contradictions of the virtues that they articulate reveal what they're actually after, rather than stopping at the contradictions and saying that they're crazy or they're dumb or don't they know what's going to happen to them. Like, for example, there's this video that I saw on Instagram of a woman who, back during, you know, after George, right after George Floyd, and she was calling, now I don't know who she was, a content creator, maybe a personality, maybe somebody can educate me. Maybe she was in a local government, held a position, but she vehemently argued that the police had to go. Now, of course, what is law enforcement, but the enforcement of white norms and codes and laws and what's left of it. And very often law enforcement officers are white males as well. So pure hatred for law enforcement and saying that it's got to go, we've got to get rid of it, and we've got to defund it. And somehow she may have participated in that. And then the other day, she was carjacked and had the living crap beat out of her. She had blood running down the side of her face in the photograph. She got exactly what she deserved, creating this lawless anti-white environment. And she turns around, of course, and says, these young people, now I'm going to go ahead and go out on a limb and guess that they were non-white anti-whites. And they probably, when they carjacked her, although I think she's not white, they probably perceived her as white. And then that made their crime that much more desirable and legitimized it in their minds. But either way, she ends up saying that the young people have to be held accountable for what was done to her specifically. So your average white person would look at this and say, well, see, she just doesn't understand where, so she's miseducated. She doesn't understand where these ideas are going to go. She has to study the Constitution. You know, she has to study the Bill of Rights. So it's a problem of the education. And you can see how a misunderstanding about the motivations leads to one false notion after another that is then built upon. So you get multiple false notions and ergo another round of suggestions for remedies that always fail. If you understand that she attacked the police department, not for all of the pretexts that she articulated, but because it's white, it's a manifestation of the power, authority, and law of the land exhibited by white people. If you understand that, then you can very easily understand that she wanted to get rid of it because it was that. She's suffering the consequences, and that's immaterial. That's post her victory. That's after her victory of inflicting this divestment on law enforcement and therefore the victimization of people in that community. The victimization of all of those people don't matter one iota, because the higher objective for her is the attack, and those people being white, non-white, whatever, because the attack is on the immoral presence of the white race and what they have projected into the world. Clearly a conversation that Elon Musk and other really wealthy people need to be privy to, rather than the sort of conversations that he ends up engaging in and repeating, a la his latest tweet about an ideology that says the weaker is always the good and the stronger is always the bad. Is that really what we see, what we experience in our lives? In reality, the stronger is able to implement the persecution. The stronger is able to implement the anti-white racial quotas. That's the reality of the world. The fiction that we receive as entertainment, sometimes it's said based on a true story, but it doesn't have to be at all because the subconscious mind can't tell the difference. That shows otherwise. Nobody ever asks, but obviously people in this community will, over the course of our lives, how did, for example, women finally force men? How did white women force white men to allow them to do anything if they hadn't done it in the previous millennia? I asked, and I'm sure a bunch of you did as well. There's no answer for that because they weren't forced. I mean, they didn't fight their way through. They weren't prevented from taking positions in society. They didn't force their way in. They were gifted these things by white men. White men gifted our cities to other people. We create these cities. We create this civilization. We should be able to say this. This is the reality of it. But it's a fiction that we have to contend with, that people live in, and that we have to speak to, which is why we employ very specific concepts that we add to, take away from, modify over time based on the success or failure of those concepts. We have the nameless one says, I had to find no white guilt to find a morally sound way to get to the roots of our problem. Very well stated. Thank you for that, brother. I'm going to take a quick, Azimuth Clark is with us. I'm going to see who else, who do we have? Samuski is in the house. He says, if not me, then who? White well-being and its existence depends on me. Very well stated. That's how a man of the West talks. That's how a woman of the West talks. It's me. I'm the one who's going to make the difference in the world. We also have Leonard says, Jason, you said America was dead long before any of us were born. When did America start to decline, and when was the death, in your opinion? Well, the decline, the presence of anti-whiteism actually predates America. We came over with it, and you can see the manifestation of it. You can see the manifestation of it in Australia, New Zealand, Canada, where you have different groups, different ethnicities of white people come over, and there are these animosities. And I refer to that as, you know, condemning the son of our mother, because we're all related. And this is, of course, as I pointed out, born out of that weakness, that selfish individualism. So the decline, if you will, was, or the roots of it were present at the very beginning of the country. But good people pushed through that and were clearly taking, if you look at these founding documents and you can see how harmonious and beautiful this is, they were saying, we come from all of these European traditions, but we're one people. Imagine that. Talk about the founding of a country that said, we come from all of these different backgrounds that were hostile and slandered each other, but we're coming together here to make one country. And what a glorious country the white race made, the United States. Of course, there are going to be flaws and et cetera that have to be worked through, not the least of which was the selfish individualism that was still present in the population and the animosity between a number of the ethnicities. But just imagine that. Imagine being able to teach to our children the founding of America was the bringing together of the totality of the white population of the world. And then look at what the totality of the white population of the world was able to do in this modicum of time in human history. Look at what we were able to accomplish. Look at how of an amazing people we can be when we recognize that we're actually a single people with many countries. Having said that, the selfish individualism and the animosities festered or were allowed to fester, or they weren't extinguished. Selfish individualists from very early on in the country's history were at work enriching and empowering themselves at our expense, the greater white population's expense, made decisions that first victimized us even before they victimized any other group of people, bringing people in, allowing people to come in who didn't share our biospirit, our instincts, and therefore our vision for society and how it's supposed to operate, brought people in slavery as well, who victimized us. What would happen to our workers? What could have been for the white population given the work that was available and the riches accruing therefrom that could have been spread out to the totality of the population, you still would have had wealthy people, but you would have had a robust middle class in very early America, that white population that would have raised all boats, but it didn't happen because selfish individualists put themselves first. White families that could have had tons of children that would have gone on to make their own fortunes instead had almost none and were starving to death because slaves were being employed, and also immigrants being employed and abused rather than the local population, even immigrants from Europe. You can think about the Irish coming over, for example, because this was a new land to them. It wasn't home yet, and they could very easily be abused. And because there was the animosities of anti-whiteism between the different ethnicities. So there's been this deleterious vein that always exposes us as a people to victimization, has throughout history. And when non-white people came into this country and they were given the opportunity to become wealthy and they became wealthy, they too, some of them, participated in anti-whiteism. And when it comes to many of these other groups, percentage of the totality of these other groups, they find individual well-being much more robustly through their people's well-being. And so there is this in-grouping and this enclaving and empowerment of these groups using the exact same tools that white people were using. So you had all of that undermining the fabric of the country. You come to the period of the War for Southern Independence, called by the victor a civil war for obvious reasons, that ended the continuity from the founding of the country. States no longer members to a union, but now an empire of states, in my opinion, of course. Check it out with CNN. And then you get to the federal banks. And they were brought into existence several times. And the most successful rebuff was by way of Andrew Jackson, who knocked them down. And we had 80 years of freedom from them until everyone knows about Jekyll Island. So at a bare minimum, it can be argued, obviously, because looking back at history, we can only see what we're told. You're either told it in a book or told it by an historian or told, or who knows. But the right to print our own money, the presence of anti-whiteism, all killed our authority over America. And that's what I mean when I say that America was already dead by the time we were born. It is a chastening. It's a chastisement. Because that it's necessary, because people are undermined by the idea that we are on the verge of losing America, because they're undermined in several ways. And one of the biggest ways is a psychological way that people are undermined. When you fear losing something, you become hesitant. You become uncertain. You are neutralized, paralyzed. We need to understand that we're not about to lose authority over America. It's been lost a long time ago. Authority over our countries and our destiny has been lost a very long time ago. If we understand this, now we can get active. Now we can have the spirit of, let's win this. Let's take this back. Let's reclaim our destiny. Let's reclaim our inheritance. That's a very different struggle than, my God, we're about to lose it all. What do we do? Let's not do that. Let's not do this. We've got to be careful on the defensive. So not only is it a reality, but psychologically, it's important in order to have the right stance relative to where we actually find ourselves in our societies across the West. And those who play sports, especially team sports, but even a sport, solo sports, you'll know firsthand what it's like, the difference between fearing losing and wanting to win. The fearing losing, you almost always lose. You make tons of mistakes. As I mentioned a moment ago, you're indecisive. You're inarticulate. You are paralyzed. When you want to win, you go after it. When there's the energy to grab that victory, to grab that laurel, it's sort of like testosterone takes over. You throw concern for superfluous or low value challenges aside and you move toward the victory. Very different state of mind. So hard to say an exact date because the human animal, the dynamics of society, it just doesn't work that way. Our minds do, and it's a simplistic way to try to grapple with things, but in reality, there's no like one moment. There's the constant interplay, sort of like if you could imagine fluids of various colors always moving toward and away, shifting relative to each other. That's much more what reality is like, the social dynamism is like for us, which is why another great big reason that the midwittery and midgetwittery and et cetera, and even the uber midwits who study their asses off and they memorize a bunch of facts, why they simply cannot grapple with our plight and society. It's beyond the comprehension of even the brightest and even the highest IQ'd and ability to process as many of these points as a very high IQ person can, which is one of the reasons why I try to get as much input as I can from bright people, because a lot of bright people who are looking at things for what they are can get a closer approximation to how things actually are in reality. When that's why it's one of the reasons why it's just so frustrating when the midwits of our race, you know, the top of that bell curve and the left side going down the left side, when they don't just say yes sir and march forward with what is working and what's beneficial. The idea that the dumbest among us can contend with the brightest anti-whites is so cripplingly inane that it's impossible to speak to. And that's why I just dismiss these people. I just ban them now. And that's what I recommend you do.
Did you know that in Roman history, a general would sooner kill someone than listen to someone who's too low in rank?
I did not know that, but wow, that's, our people were obviously very healthy back then. Wow, that's,
yeah, that's sometimes how I feel when I hear midwits and midgetwits.
God, we're gonna bring back Roman ways, folks. We're gonna bring back, the general says, I've had enough, not listening to any of this, you get the sword.
And I wanted to speak to the MP about, or rather the behavior of the midgetwits saying, you know, they just need to be educated. And you can't educate someone without moral authority. If you don't have moral authority, then you're not able to educate them.
Precisely. Beautifully said. Yes. For the white race, and it may hold true for other races in different ways or to different degrees or the exact same. I don't know. I don't care. What I care about is our people. And we need I see a request for Mike. I'll pass it over in just a moment. We, without question, need a moral matrix. And that moral matrix is coincidentally an authority matrix. So that's one of the reasons why it's not even possible to talk about luring white people with immorality, no matter how it's articulated, to engage in criminality, because it's an affront to our nature. It's an affront to our nature to burn down authority. And the only white people you see that take to it regularly and easily are the misfits, are the anti-white white people. And you get one look at them and you know right away that they're malfunctioning. There's something very wrong in them, and that makes them easy stooges of anti-whiteism, and they sacrifice themselves all the time for it. Great point. Let's see who this mic is, and we'll stay here just a little bit longer. It's our buddy Jews, who is not Jewish. And when you have the mic, brother, unmute and share your thoughts. All right, it looks like you have the mic. Yep. Let me just grab my glasses.
Good evening, sir.
Hey, good evening, brother. What's on your mind?
Yeah, great topic. You got me thinking. In terms of focusing on the other groups versus white people focusing on themselves, you can always, even if it were true for sake of argument that X group is, you know, is the problem or currently a problem or the victimizer of white people, it could always be a different group, right?
Right. Precisely. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So even if, like, currently it's group A, you know, if it were group A, it could be group B or group C or whatever, because it's the tactics that are fundamentally that matter. So what really becomes relevant, and this is the point that I would make, is that, you know, white people stop, sort of pause, self-reflect, consider what is it about, you know, white, you know, the whole, you know, we have, white people have traits, sort of tendencies and inclinations, biospirit. So what is it about the white biospirit that has sort of led them to be susceptible and vulnerable to all this stuff? And particularly to your point right now, to be selfish individuals and not to be as cohesive as a group. So it's really just like, or you can really go out, you know, you go back to, you know, Art of War, you know, you don't know your enemy, you lose a thousand battles. If you don't know yourself, you lose a million battles. Mm-hmm. So white people need to, like, know what, and then once they get that, once they kind of, white people understand, you know, what are our weaknesses, and then fix that, and then it resolves everything, right?
Yeah, precisely. Yes. When we see, and this is, you know, it's like a, when you wield this, folks, it's like, it's a giant golden key to understanding our plight, that there's something clearly in us, and what's most salient about us that lends itself to anti-whiteism is the selfish individualism that you could talk about it in different ways. Maybe it's the way the creator made us. Maybe it is, maybe it's a challenge that our people have to overcome to evolve through time or what have you. Or you could say that, well, there are no gods, or maybe there could still be a god, but you still have this evolutionary period in this harsh, cold climate. And so somehow we have ended up with this trait of selfish individualism, which, when we are by ourselves, has worked beautifully. So it makes sense. You now have a scenario, though, where these genetic tools, in the presence of other peoples that don't operate the exact same way, and it's not good or bad or it's indifferent, it's just they operate differently, it appears, these tools end up being a great weakness to us. And we can argue also that even though it was a benefit to us to a degree in isolation, these selfish individualism to a degree was a benefit, we would have still been a stronger, better people and not subject to the whims of selfishly individualistic tyrants in our midst. if we practiced a broader understanding of individual well-being by way of group well-being. So in other words, you could never have a scenario if you had a people, a white people, that achieved individual well-being by way of group well-being, a king or a dictator or would be impossible under the understanding, the modern sort of operating understanding of these things, that they exploit the people for their own enrichment or betterment. So that would have certainly be a better place than even what we've been able to achieve. So you can think about us even being to a degree undermined, still achieving glorious things, but undermined to a degree by the selfish individualism. And that's of course what leads to this big hatred of our brothers who are, and sisters who are slightly different. And that is the birth of anti-whiteism. So you're 100% right, brother. Even if you were to grant to somebody you're debating that, okay, it's all this group or that group today, being rid of them is not even possible. But being rid of them for the sake of argument doesn't end anti-whiteism. It proceeds. Things won't get better for the white masses at all. We're at a stage where anti-whiteism is such a powerful phenomenon that it is excluding increasingly the group that many people would say are it, that's all there is. They're it. And if they're not there, then it's not there. And you can see, of course, how low IQ of a take that is. And we've likened it to the take of like the bee's nest on the porch. And if they just get rid of the bee's nest, then there are no more bee stings, but no more buzzing around your head. The reality, though, for somebody like this, if we were to inject reality into the metaphor, you would have the phenomenon of bee stings and the bees buzzing you and getting around your food and everything, but it wouldn't matter how many bees nests you got rid of, and there wouldn't be any bees to even see. You would still be getting stung, and you would still be vexed by bees while you're trying to have your picnic or eat out on your deck or your porch or whatever it is. And they would just be there without even being visible. So that's what we have to contend with, the stings and the vexing of the bees, rather than a bee's nest here or there. And if we take care of that, then we take care of what, folks? The stings, the vexing us while we are, and isn't that what we want? To end the stings, to end the vexing us. If we deal with that, then we've remedied our problem. Anybody attempting, including white people, attempting to enrich themselves, I mean, for God's sakes, Kevin Trudeau is out of jail and ready to make himself a decamillionaire again on the backs of foolish people. And I'm not saying everything he ever shared but is false or wrong, but he's out there again. And that sort of thing in a healthy white society would not be permitted. The reason why we have the poisons in our food, especially in the United States, is selfish individualism that ended up being extolled and lauded to the heavens as this great virtue for America and for our people. And at the end of the day, as a consequence, people will end up saying things to me like, you can't expect Elon Musk to get involved in this fight. He stands to lose too much. Putting his money and his businesses ahead of the flesh of our people that create his businesses and his money. So yes, I absolutely can expect him to put, and I demand of him that he put it all on the line for the source of all of his enrichment, for the source of all of his own intelligence, sagacity, and organizational abilities. Where else does it come from but this great lineage of a wonderful people that has bequeathed it to him, for him now to say, well, I hope there's a red wave Because if there isn't, then I'm just going to have to take my money to protect myself, maybe flee the country or whatever. And I'll leave all these white, just like South Africa, because he's a South African. I'll leave all these white people to whatever their fate will be. You know who would not do that? Who would absolutely not do that? The group of people that a lot of ne'er-do-wells, do-nothings want to condemn all the time. Who want to complain about how, why aren't they doing anything to stop the anti-whiteism at this or that university? Why, what are you actually, are you really saying that? Are you saying that out loud? Because that's the kind of thing that is so tremendously, I mean, in the stratospheric level of stupid and infantile, that I would think an adult would at least know, if they, even if the thought went through their head, they would know, oops, I better not say that out loud. That's going to say a lot about how immature I am and how much of a do-nothing I am. So great, great point there. Let's get out a big round of applause. Big raucous emojis, 96s if you can, 96s. For the one and only man who I will allow to work on my eyes. It's Dr. Igor, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Igor. He is financially gifted over here on Cash App a munificent 50 white well-being dollars. God bless you. Putting an end to anti-whiteism, and he writes with that 50 glorious protect the white babies from anti-whiteism dollars and 07. So we can get a stiff salute from the heroes here in service to white well-being. Thank you so much. Workers, Elon, white millionaires out there in their millions. I mean, look it up, folks. How many white people have millions of dollars and are just partying with it? I want you to look closely, millionaires, white millionaires and billionaires. These are working class people. These are working class people. And these dollars, you make this kind of money in the blink of a human eye. They're working for a living and fighting for a future. So don't you dare sit on the sidelines and watch regular folks bleeding cash and shedding tears, actual physically bleeding, and hope that they create a red wave for you so that you can continue to have your enrichment and parties and nice vehicles and houses all over the place. Don't you dare do that. I tell you what, if they do, and we are able to recapture our destiny, there'll be a reckoning for those kind of people. If Musk watches on the entire time and we're able to recapture our destiny, if I had anything to do with it, he would be begging for the anti-whites to come back. Begging. God bless you, Dr. Igor. And thank you all for celebrating this champion. Let me make sure we didn't miss anybody. And I will just do a refresh here and there. We are coming up on the midnight hour here in the once great state of Virginia, across from Mordor on the Potomac. And we'll be wrapping it up, I think, pretty soon. If you have a microphone and you have something you want to say before we wrap it up, you can just jump in. You can just unmute as I'm refreshing. But otherwise, I'm going to see if there are any other financial gifts. It does look like we have one. An ice cream. Well, wait a second. It's three ice cream cones of cryptocurrency over there on DLive. And that's from Fledgling. Thank you so much, Fledgling. Can you believe I can read it from there? Three ice cream cones of cryptocurrency. God bless you. Let me check over here on Odyssey and see if we have any tags or financial gifts. Looks like no gifts, but we do have a tag. And it, what does it say? The actual reason that is this PD, I think of the first two letters, says the actual reason, in his opinion, that TikTok is getting banned. I'll jump in right there. It's actually not a ban of TikTok, but perhaps you're using that colloquially. He says it's because of all the criticism of Israel and support of Palestine. So this is the kind of all or nothing thinking, especially relative to Israel and Jewish people in general. It's a kind of all or nothing that they have. They're omnipotent. They can make anything happen in the world. It lends itself, this thinking, to this argument that appeals to people of a superficial mindset, maybe midwittery and lower, that if you criticize Jewish people for being in positions of power, then you suffer. And that therefore is proof that they are in power. This is called specious reasoning, and it can be intentional, but often I think it is unintentional because it's just a consequence of the thinking prowess of the person who is sharing that view, or perhaps they've just learned it and they haven't had an opportunity to think through and see how it's wrong. But it's specious reasoning. So they'll say, essentially the argument, the way it goes is, well, if you complain about Germans controlling things, nothing happens. But if you complain about Jews controlling things, then you get in trouble. Then that's a consequence, rather, of, on one side, the selfish individualism of the white race, and for a percentage of Jewish people who work together, on the other side, who work together for individual well-being by way of group well-being. If you were to say that any mildly believable claim that is a slander of the totality of the Jewish people, if you were to articulate any mildly believable claim, they would act as a unit, that percentage, not the totality of Jewish people, but a certain percentage of them would act to oppose you for the statement. Now, for example, if you were to say that if you had a big enough audience and you said to your audience that Jewish people, and then I'll add a little bit of a space here, but then claim that they eat children, and you were saying this to your audience, and your audience, this large audience, was heeding it, Jewish people, that particular percentage, would move to shut you down, shut you up, criticize you. Why? Not because they eat children, but because if you slander them as a group, they're going to be, they perceive that as harming them as individuals. And that's exactly how we have to operate. That's not something that you can condemn, as we've talked about before. It's a behavior that we have to emulate. If you condemn it, you won't emulate it. If you call that group action for the defense of the honor of the reputation of your people, that individuals coming together for the defense of the reputation of your people so as to achieve individual well-being, if you call that a great evil, then it cannot also be a virtue for us. So that's a behavior. So if you say that the whole of this people is in control, they can see the writing on the wall, that could end up being harmful to them as individuals by way of harmful to their group. And they will act accordingly. That's why you'll get this blowback. Not because they're in complete control of everything. Now, that doesn't mean what I just said. That doesn't mean that there aren't powerful Jewish people. And that doesn't mean that there aren't anti-white Jewish people. Because there are powerful Jewish people. There are anti-white Jewish people. It just means that the first understanding is inaccurate, and therefore, or misunderstanding, I guess I should say, and therefore can't be used as a basis for constructing remedies. What ends up happening when you take that misunderstanding, you come up with this illogical misunderstanding for a remedy that says, well, you've got to get rid of all these people. Nothing can be done until you get rid of all of them. which of course is immoral to the vast majority, millions and millions of white people, and also impossible. So yet again, another wall in the way of our understanding and therefore our ability to advance our cause to put an end to our victimization. Now, is it possible that there are Jewish people who object to the anti-Israeli sentiment, pro-Palestinian sentiment on TikTok? Of course. But the conclusion that that's why it's happening is erroneous. There are other reasons that are afoot as well when it comes to TikTok and the communist Chinese ability to hoover up data and guide the psychology of a giant chunk, an expanding chunk of the population, to guide an understanding. It's a reckless sort of splinter in the otherwise complete control that anti-whites wield over the population, because it's like a Ted Turner or a Donald Trump wild card. Will it continue in most ways to be anti-white? Maybe yes, maybe no. But that's something that anti-whites will never tolerate. And so that is also an engine to force TikTok to sell to an American company or firm or person or whatever it might be. But you can see how far afield you get in being wrong when you have this Jewish-centric focus for all of our victimization. And wouldn't it be nice if all of the anti-whiteism on TikTok was opposed with such joint effort and power that we could say there won't be any more anti-whiteism on this platform, and if there is, you're going to sell it. We're going to force you to sell it. That would be fantastic. So when I hear like somebody claim, well, they're saying nasty things about Jews over there, and by God, those Jews won't allow nasty things to be said about them, I say, wow, I wish we could do that. I don't say the Jews are awful for that at all. I say, I wish we could do that. I would like white people to come together behind leadership like me, people who have, and the smart people who have come to this community that have shown the way and demonstrated success. I'd like white people to do that rather than just be shadows of other groups of people. And that, to the point that was made earlier, is evidence of that selfish individualism that we are stricken with, is that rather than come together as our own people, we take on this bizarre shadow haunting of other groups of people. And that's something that white people are going to have to contend with if we're ever going to get healthy. We're never going to find our way out of this if we continue shadow haunting other groups of people and hating them for their unity, hating them for their group action, thinking about them all day long, slandering their victories. That won't get us anywhere. It's after midnight, though. After midnight, we gonna let it all hang out. De Novo says, I think that's a wrong take. They'll act like bad actors, like, and then you have this, I'm not going to say that word there. They communicate. Do you actually believe, or is that a joke? Do you actually believe that Jewish people communicate in the same way that like ants communicate? I know, it's lost.
I wanted to speak to the, I just wanted to reinforce that, yeah, even if it was, the focus was Israel, it's the wrong focus to bring that up, because let's say there was a lot of negativity towards another group on TikTok, and that's the reason it was banned. Focusing on how things are negative towards another group is not our focus.
Precisely. It's unproductive. It's totally unproductive for us, precisely. Even if, like Jews was saying, like, I think it was Jews, even if we grant, in the case of a debate, that their position is true, it is still the most harmful and unproductive way to proceed to the objective of ending our victimization. We just simply cannot get there by way of that understanding. So yeah, without question, the way to go is to focus on us. And isn't it something like if, let me ask you all this, and we've got to go in a minute because it is after midnight, but if you're listening to a content creator, organization leader, whatever it is, and you see this bill come up about TikTok and others, really the bill is actually about Elon Musk and Twitter. It should be called the Ban Twitter or the Control or Ban Musk bill. That's what it should be called. It's all about Musk. It's totally about Musk. And which is why it's worded the way it is. I mean, you can specifically, you could go through it as we did, and you could almost write Elon Musk in, and then it makes perfect sense in a number of the spots. You're like, oh, okay, Elon Musk. We'll do this to Elon Musk. We'll do that to Elon Musk. It makes perfect sense then. But what was I going to, where was I going to go with that? See, it's after midnight. Haven't had any sleep.
You could just write Elon Musk into the bill, so.
Could write Musk into because the bill. Of
how, yeah, I'm trying to help you here.
This is what happens when you go too long with too little sleep. It's like the inverse of the Holiday Inn commercials where they the guy, like, he doesn't know anything about anything, but he shows up at like a quantum physics conference, and then he shares something brilliant, and they're like, where did you study? He's like, I did, and I slept at a Holiday Inn last night and had a full night's of sleep, and I feel fantastic. The bill, being the Elon Musk bill, is what really matters. But if you have a content creator, and the content creator, relative to this bill, is not talking about all the anti-whiteism on TikTok, but is talking about Jews not happy with the stance on TikTok, then what is your content creator, organization leader leading you to? Like, what's their objective? What is it they're trying to accomplish? If it's all about Jewish people, then I mean, what kind of group are you? If they care about white people, they care about the country that you're in, then shouldn't all the conversation center around us and our victimization? Shouldn't it all be that? Rather than what are the Jews doing? It's just it's a tell. It's the ultimate tell in poker. It's like the guy you're watching turns his hand around and every card says Jewish person. You're like, what am I listening to you for? What is this all about? I mean, if you're there to be this atom, this isolated individual, who is going to get together with other isolated individuals and complain about Jewish people, well, then I guess you're in the right place if that's what they're doing there. But when it comes to ending our victimization, we need to be talking about, and have you heard this elsewhere? Talking about how anti-white TikTok is, talking about how it has to be taken away from the communist Chinese, because obviously the communist Chinese are going to push the most deleterious ideology in their adversaries' countries, right? So it's got to be sold for that reason. Giving any time to whether or not Jews care or not, it should be immaterial. if you're working toward the end of our victimization. And so that's where I wanted to go with the content creator. Looks like Calypso has joined us. Hello to you, a good sir, big champion. Rory, sorry,
yeah,
brother.
About what obstacles they're focusing on. So are they focusing on the obstacles to white well-being in the bill, or are they focusing on the obstacles to criticizing Israel?
They don't mention in the bill.
I'm rhetorically right. asking.
Yes, exactly. So, exactly then. Precisely. What are the objections? And it, and you'll find, you go to other content creators, if it's the explicit white sympathetics, the vast majority, it's just going to be this focus on Jewish people and what they're doing again. If you go to the implicit community, it's a completely sort of anodyne, neutered take on the bill, and sometimes a couple of conspiracy theories tossed in there to make the entertainment a little bit more intriguing. But we should, everybody, all content creators should be talking about how anti-white it is, how communist Chinese, how it's totally in their interest to push like crazy this corrosive ideology of anti-whiteism, how therefore it shouldn't be in their hands in a Western country, and also talk about how it's actually written not for the communist Chinese, but to undermine Elon Musk and Twitter, which, although a lot of folks today are seeing Twitter's struggles and et cetera, they have a lot that they're working on, and it could become a much larger, robust, and wealthier platform. And that's what they have to anticipate. That's at the national level. That's the kind of things that they have to be looking out into the future and anticipating. If you think that big international companies spend time on what could happen to us 5, 10, 20, 25, 30 years out and taking steps to address those things, countries go even further and in more detail. They have to, because if they don't, they don't continue to exist. We have Jay Bishop, let's get some 07s round of applause for Jay Bishop. She has financially gifted 20 US dollars here at the end of our roll in. And with those 20 white well-being save the white baby dollars, she writes for the recapture of our destiny, 07s. Big 07s back to you. Thank you so much for your service to white well-being and for this financial gift. Yes, it did come in. I do see it here. Thank you. I really appreciate it. And did we have another one over here? No, and I don't see anybody tagging me over on Rumble, but hello to Andy, who says, yo, white brothers. A big yo back to you. Well, we will be back on Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And I invite everybody who has heard my voice in the Twitter space, even if you were listening anonymously, or you listen in replay, or you were present and we could see you, I invite you all to join us on Sunday, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's our going free gathering. It's kind of like this, but it's more high energy. And we talk about our victories. So it will get you fired up to make victories of your own in your life, which is what we need. More and more victories for white well-being. And one more look at the live chat. Let's see. Make sure I didn't miss anybody. Yeah, I don't know about that whole. Sloth says, eat some meat, some beef. Yeah, I actually have some downstairs. I will be eating as soon as we're done.
Okay. De novo was joking. I was like, that's got to be a joke. That can't be real. Oh, that's so funny. Oh, but he says, oh, no, I'm sorry. I flew by that and I saw a joke and I saw that I thought it was he was joking. Here's his first message. And then here's the second. I'll put these babies on. Okay, I stand corrected. He says that he wasn't joking. He said that they are all on the same agenda. I obviously push back on that. And he says, thanks for making me feel stupid. And he says he is unsubbing. Well, that is your, this is definitely not the place for you if you are of this mind that an entire group of human beings have all the exact same mindset and they're going to act in concert by way of pheromones. I mean, I can't even fathom. I can't even fathom how silly that is. But it's also, even for, like, we've been making the point tonight, that even if I were to cede to you for the point of the conversation that your assumption about them is true, as preposterous as it is, it's still not going to benefit us to focus on another group of people. You can't become a people, which is what we need to be. And what does it mean to become a people? It doesn't mean that we all eat apple pie or have bacon and eggs in the morning or have the same flag or what have you. It means to be a people is to seek individual well-being by way of group well-being. That is what it means to be a people. And then all of the other things are the trappings, are the attire that you put on top of that. So you can't become a people by hating another group of folks. And you can't end our victimization by attributing a phenomenon that we cause to be to another group of people. So I guess for you, De Novo, you're going to end up complaining about Jewish people working together and getting results, some Jewish people working together and get results that they're happy with for the rest of your life. And that sounds like a pretty shitty life to me. Unproductive as well. Having said that, see you all on Sunday. Roll out.